Hello, welcome to Kong as King, the internet fan site for the movie we're making, the remake of King Kong. And I'm here on the set, the first night of shooting. This is a night shoot, we're just waiting for it to get dark. And this is the venture behind me, in front of blue screens and here in the Wellington studios. So it's exciting, about to get started making this movie. And welcome on board, and hope you're going to be following our progress as we go through the next few months. Thank you. So we're on day four of shooting Kong, and we're just doing the scene in the diner where Denham is trying to convince Anne Darrow to be part of the voyage. Very similar scene in the original film. And so over here is the diner set.
Specials, we've got meatloaf on there. 5 cents a slice.
Mmm, tasty.
Sounds rolling.
21 Delta, take one.
Background. And action.
Vaudeville, huh? I worked vaudeville once. That's a tough audience. If you don't kill them fast, they kill you.
I'd love to just introduce you to Naomi Watts and Jack Black, playing Anne Darrow and Carl Denham.
Hello.
Hello.
This is the Kong as King website.
Oh, all right. I've heard a lot about you.
it's actually brand new.
Oh.
But you're about to hear
it's
a lot.
It's good to meet you.
Yes.
Well, I can't believe they get to see me in costume and makeup. Isn't that, like, forbidden?
Well, it normally is, but we want to let anyone that's interested, just a few little secrets.
So, you lucky sons
of guns. I love this hat. This is actually based on Fay Wray's hat from the original movie. It's pretty cool, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah, I think it's great. It's a little tribute to Fay.
Little homage.
Yeah.
Right. Many more to come.
So, yeah, so check in and we'll keep putting little snippets on this website from time to time.
Bye for now. See ya.
So this is day six of the shoot, and here in Wellington it's raining, but we're still going to carry on shooting anyway. We've got a scene on the venture today. As you can see, the boat's on the parking lot. I couldn't face the idea of shooting in a ship at sea. I get terribly seasick. So we built the ship here on the parking lot on solid ground. We've got blue screens surrounding it so that anything that we want to do, ocean, sky, can just be superimposed in later on. The scene we're doing today involves Driscoll and Denham walking along the side of the ship having a conversation. Crank the wind up, more wind, more wind. One of the really cool things, if you're a King Kong fan, is this. Have a look at this. Isn't that neat? I've got a feeling this is going to go on my office wall when the movie's finished, so don't look for it on eBay. So I think I've got my name down for that. Now, that is really cool. Now, of course, one of the skills of being an actor on this film is to pretend that you're on a ship. And so Adrien and Jack have been rehearsing their sea technique. Okay, it's all figured out?
You ready? Yeah, you want to actually give you a taste?
You're going to demonstrate too. All right,
okay, so I'll come down here and we'll just have a look at this. So you have to imagine that the boat's going up and down and it's rocking and the horizon's going up and down. Now these guys have got it worked out perfectly. Okay, and action. And really. Well, that was all right, but I think you need another drink.
Yeah, agreed.
Okay.
One more drink and it'll be perfect.
Excellent. All right, okay. So after the rain of yesterday, here on day seven, we're actually inside the studio, although it's a perfectly sunny day outside. That's the way it always happens. We're in Studio B, which is not so much of a studio as a rather grotty old shed that we use. Actually, some quite well-known sets have been built here. This is exactly where Bag End was built for Lord of the Rings. Then we've got the interior of the venture. The ship that you saw in the parking lot is just for the outside of the ship.
when you go into the cabins, we've got all of those inside the studio.
It's really quite comfortable.
We're filming some scenes in very tiny rooms today. It is a bit like being back in Bag End, actually, doing some stuff in Anne Darrow's cabin, the corridors of the venture, people trying to get past each other. We're deliberately making it narrow, pokey. The ship is kind of run down. It's not the most glamorous vessel in the world. Not the most comfortable bed in the world. We figured it would take about 6 weeks to go from New York to the South Seas, and it's not exactly the sort of place I'd like to spend 6 weeks in. But we're trying to get the day finished. It's 25 past six, and we're supposed to be wrapping at about 8:30. We've got one more scene to shoot, haven't we, Caro?
We have got one more scene to shoot.
Caro's our first AD, and we're starting to get a little stressed about trying to get this done, but we're going with handheld cameras. Come and just have a look at the preparation that we're doing.
Lift it up a tad more, will you?
Lift that roof up a bit.
Which one? The one I'm standing on?
Yeah, the one you're standing on.
Everyone's kind of going crazy in here. We're taking out ceiling panels, trying to get lights to poke through because we're going to have the acres down here, and we can pop the ceilings out and get lamps in and all this sort of stuff. And everyone's a bit stressed and busy at the moment, but let's come into it a little look. There's that Andrew, our DP, and Reg, our gaffer. Hey, hi, Giles. Everybody's busy trying to get this scene shot, so anyway, we'll hopefully get it done.
Okay, put it back. I need a black up there too to stop all this blue light getting in here.
Yeah, we've got one under your reach.
Thank you.
So you just want one of those 650s up?
He walks in there, cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha, yep, and then slams the door in his face and we're left on Preston.
Here we go, please.
At action.
Just strike straight ahead, sir.
Cut.
Good, so we got the master shot of that scene done. We've got a couple of close-ups, sort of inserts to do later on, but at least we got the main choreography nailed. Very, very difficult little scene to shoot in this one, but it gives it mood working in a confined space. Andrew, wouldn't you agree?
Oh, yes, absolutely, Pete. Good. Rather claustrophobic, actually.
Yeah. So the old days at Bag End.
Yeah, except the ceilings are a touch higher.
Hey, here it is, day 105 at Miniatures. We're shooting mostly trees for the jungle scenes. This 20-scale tree would be about 30 feet high in the real world. And we've had to scale down every little
Sorry,
bit of it.
We have to go to main unit.
Let's go down to main unit where they're shooting on day 8 and see how Carl Denham is handling his movie camera. Here we are, getting ready to shoot an actual shot with this very ancient camera, a Bell & Howell 2709 from 1916, which we resurrected for the movie. It's exactly the same kind of camera that was in the film. Mr. Denham here is operating his own camera, as he often did, and learned this magic 3 turns a second trick of turning the crank so that he gets a constant speed.
And the trick of it is to do it without shaking the camera itself, which is really difficult. But if I slow it down, I can make it really smooth, but it has to be fast like this. It has to be three revolutions per second, or else the characters I film are going to be moving too fast, like Babe Ruth around the bases at the speed of light.
Cut.
Nairi, I'm the plane spotter. I sit on top of the hill above Wellington Airport and let Kara know if there's any planes coming.
Yeah, that way we know when to roll. Yeah. Occasionally we get it wrong,
okay,
but not too much.
Dude, so the problem is that we're speaking, but we got Air New Zealand and Air Qantas messing this up. I'm gonna have to come back to New Zealand in May next year to do all this again.
Mayday,
That's got that little sucker.
So if the planes weren't enough, tonight we're getting soaked by these things.
They're going to spray us with water from a great height, and we've taken all precautions, which means you put a plastic bag over the camera.
We're on the Venture in what's supposed to be the middle of the storm, so we're trying to create a feeling of boat movement. You know, everyone's having to move like the old Star Trek days, falling sideways. But once you get fans and wind, and we're doing it with handheld cameras, trying to keep it a very busy time, and the actors, unfortunately, are having to get drenched. So they're spending the entire night being wet, freezing and cold. I'm sure it can't be much fun.
I'm so cold right now.
And at least I get to go into the dry cabin and don't get wet at all.
I told you so.
It's fun to watch. You cut the stuff up and you put it with all the visual effects. We're going to have crashing waves and big ocean stormy seas outside here, and it's going to, I'm sure, look pretty good. It's actually working very well. Are you cold?
I think I peed in the wetsuit.
You peed in the wetsuit? Well, don't tell anybody. And nobody here would just shh. So here we are on day 14, and we're inside some animal cages. And unfortunately, because they're animals, we have to deal with the very unfortunate subject of waste matter. And I'm very sorry to introduce a toilet aspect to this video diary. I feel very embarrassed to do that, because obviously we want to keep this as artistic and highbrow as possible. But nonetheless, the art department have had a very difficult mission to accomplish this week to prepare for this scene.
Try this quick quiz. What do camels eat?
Well, to make sure that we got good looking poo, we went and did some research. So we've got the various animal manure reference folder.
So we've just had one of the researchers go up to the zoo and get a whole lot of references of animal droppings and things. So yeah, I'm just really just doing a bit of R&D into some camel poo. I'll probably get the job to do the Kong poo now if they like this stuff, which will be huge.
So this is Tony's fabulous pose. I'm butchering.
Could have a bit more salt.
Right, so outside the other day saw the camel poo. We've moved on to the big cats. Bit of tiger poo going on here. Just had Jan, the producer, around with some kids, and they were all gagging, so I thought if I could make the producer gag, then I'm not doing too bad, am I?
What on earth have we got here? Look at this crap! Oh, yuck!
I have the doggy doos, or should I have the mouth pups, or the big turdy bits, or the really sloppy muddy turds? Yeah. No thanks.
Andrew, You haven't got a shot, have you?
Yeah, I've got a shot of the poo.
Oh, just the poo.
We should make it kind of go all the way into the cage, like it sort of dribbles out the side of the cage here. Not the edge of it, because of the thing. I think we should leave it, obviously, leave a bit of a clear space around here. Just kind of have it around. Yeah, but this is going to work, Simon. There's little bits of straw and stuff make it look like it's old.
It'll look good in 3D, actually.
3D, cool.
Smell of it.
Hello, fans.
Hi. We're going to be dumped on by the dump tanks.
What is dump tanks?
Those ones over there, mate. He goes back. They've got water in them. See what I mean?
All right.
And so?
So the water comes and lands on top of you, and makes you quite a lot shorter and wetter.
I need to talk
shorter
to somebody.
And wetter.
I can't really get wet again. Who do I talk to?
So it's day 16, and we're continuing the storm scene that you may have seen a little bit of the other night. But the difference tonight is that we have dump tanks. And these are these things that are behind me, which contain, I don't know, hundreds, thousands of gallons of water.
And they're basically big buckets that we release, and they drop this huge slew of water over the ship and, of course, over the actors. The idea is to simulate the storm. This is a little bit further than just the rain that we were doing the other night. This is kind of the sea smashing against the side of the Venture. So we're going to have these things going, and instead of using stunt people, we're actually going to use our actors tonight. They're all standing around, I think, terrified, because they don't quite know what's going to happen.
Anybody feels worried about anything at any time, simply yell out to me or my name very loudly. Sorry about that plane. And safety at all times.
Danger's my second name. Stephen Danger Hall. I live in danger, fear and pain. I say, come in danger, sit down, put your feet up, have a cup of tea, relax, stay a while.
So Jack, so the idea here is we're going to dump water on a couple of stunt guys so you can watch and see what the damage is.
Okay.
So you know what to expect.
All right, cool.
I don't understand this dump tank thing that you keep talking about.
Looks like Sir Jackson is mounting a one-man invasion.
Have you ever had so much fun in water with your clothes on?
I can think of a couple of times.
Yes, I know. I'm sure you're young.
Yeah, maybe.
We're into day 18 today on the shoot, and it's the second day for our dump tanks, putting the waves up over the boat. Our dump tanks basically are consisting of huge boxes of water on pivoting cradles up the top that we can release from ropes at the bottom or even up on the tables.
These are our firing mechanisms. We have a safety pin in all the time when the tank's full. When we're ready to shoot, the safety will come out, the pin will come out, and it's ready to fire. And the ropes pull back, and that fires the tank.
The wave's created by a kicker at the bottom of the dump tank, which we alter the angle on to either make the wave come out steep or at a shallow angle. Tip the kicker up, we rise into a higher wave, it'll go right up over the boat. Flatter angle for not so much, so all totally adjustable. Our three dump tanks at the moment, we're running around about 8,500 litres on three platforms, ranging from 9 metres down to 6 metres.
It takes about 3 minutes to fill each tank.
Well, each one of these tanks is 1,000 litres, so that's a ton. And we've got bigger ones below us, and they're about a ton and a half.
We're running fairly small dump tanks compared to a lot of the overseas movies, which are able to build them in studios with big fixed steel towers. We have to keep ours on portable towers because we're moving them around all the time. We have in the past used tanks the size of shipping containers where we've dumped 120,000 litres of water in one hit. So there is, with if you've got the facilities, no limit to what you can do. Basically, that's the anatomy of the dump tanks, and hope we get into another successful night of wave making. Cheers.
So here we are on day 20. We're finishing off our dump tank sequence tonight, so I thought today would be quite fun to give you an overview of other things that are happening on the production, because, of course, while we're here shooting the sequence, the art department have to prepare for scenes that are coming up in the near future. There's a huge number of people working very hard at the moment to get ready ahead of us. It's like laying the rails in front of a steam train that's bearing down behind them.
And we're basically building sets, big sets, for the next 3-4 weeks worth of shooting.
We're at the village wall on Skull Island. In the old movie, you may recall, the gates through to the jungle where Colin comes bursting through. So that section there with the steps and the gap, that's where we're putting our gates, that's where Colin's going to come into the village. We're forging ahead under extreme pressure. We'll have it ready for shooting in 5 weeks.
The real pressure is just the time. The set that we're building for some of the jungle, some cliff spaces that we need, is going to be shooting in about 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks, I think it is. And today it's not looking remotely finished.
So we've got 14 days to finish this set. It's a huge action scene here, lots of business on Skull Island, and we're going to be working 24 hours a day for the next 14 days to get the set finished. So it's going to be a bit of fun.
We're having a few problems. There's a shortage of containers in New Zealand, and containers are the building blocks of these big structures that we make, and for some reason there doesn't seem to be any left in the country. This boat here, which is a fake boat, is being replicated on a real boat. The Uia is a boat that we purchased 6 or 8 months ago, and we designed a venture to fit on that superstructure. So the design of this boat is actually based on the real boat that we bought first. It's like putting the cart before the horse, and then we're now turning our real boat back into a fake boat.
And then when we've secured the whole thing and painted it up, we'll take it to sea as the venture.
We've had to build a huge new concrete soundstage that we've actually just been building the soundstage and building a set inside the soundstage at the same time in order to get it ready.
This is Kong's stage. We're building this specifically for the Kong movie. We're building a set inside because we can't wait for the studio to be finished. We're shooting it here in a week and a half. So
I mean, it's just the reality of filmmaking. There's all these treasures everywhere. Here on the set, you know, we're just waiting for our actors to arrive to try to get this finished tonight. That's one form of pressure, but there's a lot of other people who are desperately working, trying to get their department sorted out, ready for us to arrive on the day that we're supposed to be shooting.
And action.
So here we are on day 22, and we're inside our tiny little sets in the ship. And we've got John Sumner over here playing Herb,
Hi.
The cameraman. Kyle Chandler's playing Bruce Baxter.
Oh.
And this is the mess and the galley of the ship, the Venture. And the best person to give you a tour of the galley would actually be Lumpy the cook.
Well, I hope Lumpy gives a better tour of the galley than he does preparing the food.
Hello, what are you doing here? Who said you could come in here? What are you doing here? This is my galley, this is my private galley, my domain, and if anybody wants to come in here, they have to ask me. So what do you want, hmm? Oh, I see. You want a little tour, do you? Right, OK, come on in. Right. Well, we've been at sea for quite a while now. We're running out of veg. This is kind of what we've got left. I'm probably going to have to make something like a fricassee or something out of these. As you can see, they're a bit dodged, but we'll sort them out, don't worry. I'm saving that for, special occasion. I mean, the thing is, the secret about cooking on board, you can get away with anything, right? You just got to make it taste nice. So I always add things whenever I can, and the crew most of the time can't tell the difference between good or bad food. So what I tend to do, for instance, with cheese, like, they're used to the consistency of cheese, so I tend to get a piece of soap and mix it up with egg whites, put it out in the sun and add a little bit of prune juice to it, soak it, marinate it out in the sun, and it comes up this nice kind of smoky flavour. It's rather beautiful. But no, they never know. That's the secret of the job, really, because you don't have the best things to cook with. However, now I've collected these spices from all over the world. These come from Africa, India, Asia, Mexico, Bolivia, and of course, I met this bloke in Mexico and he gave me a whole stack of walnuts, and I've got hundreds of them, so at the moment I tend to be quite walnut-based with my cooking. Yeah, see, Troy hasn't done his washing up. Someone hasn't finished their dinner there. I mean, you see, that's a waste. That's what I call a waste, you know? I mean, I'd have that. That's a lot of vitamins in there, so I'll have that. That is one of the, see, that's a swordfish pie with walnut. And, well, that's really nice. You want some? Part of my duties are a medical officer. So, you know, a lot of the young sailors, when they first come on board, haven't got a clue. They stand in the wrong place. They get the ropes trapped around their legs. And, of course, you know, sometimes these come in handy for a quick amputation. Other things, we did have a couple of sailors obviously die on trips, and I do the embalming of the bodies, and we give them a nice burial, chuck them off the side and all that, so that's all right. And that's about it, really, innit? I'm going to have to relieve myself, so I'm going to head over to the little boys' room. So this is the sacrosanct place of the entire vessel. You can pamper yourself, make yourself feel a little bit, you know, a little bit jolly. Take a nice relaxing bath. You know, if you shut the door and turn on all the taps, you can get a little bit of steam going and, you know, get yourself clean. And people do that every month or two. This doesn't actually work at the moment. The flush doesn't work very well. So it does get a little bit on the smelly side, but, you know, we all put up with that. This soap is something that I made again with raisins and you know, odd bits and pieces. You know, people wash themselves with that. You know, they like to clean themselves up every now and then. I don't know why, but if people want to fancy a little bit of entertainment, we've got a big stash of these. I sell these as well, which I'll get when I go on shore. I'll find out all the local shops that sell these this kind of literature, and there's some quite nifty stories in here. And very nifty stories, actually. Very nifty indeed. And so I'm going to actually have to say goodbye to you at this point, and I'll see you later on.
This is a slate that we're using in the movie. And as you can see, it's a Denham picture. It may be a Peter Jackson film, but it's a Carl Denham picture.
So this is the slate we're using for King Kong. It's an important part of the production. It syncs up our sound and our vision.
Hello, sound.
Speed. Speed. Speed.
Sound speed.
62 Alpha, take 2, A marker, guide track.
The part of the slate that's important for the sound department is the verbal idea of what shot it is, so that when it comes down to editing, they can actually sync up the correct sound slate with the correct picture take.
The clap is because it's maybe the only bit of applause that the actors will get for their take, so they give them the clap before so they don't have to get it afterwards, in case they don't.
The camera is on a 20mm,
yeah.
Roll number E283,
yeah.
B camera 40mm, roll number B15.
Okay, so we'll go to Bravo.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's a daily occurrence, times 100. They'll come and tell me they've changed lenses or they've changed rolls. Usually when they've changed lenses, we'll go to a new shot, so then I give them a new slate number.
Basically, I get the slate information from Victoria, which is the scene number, which I log into the board with a marker pen. Very simple technology. As we move through a scene,
and action,
and cut.
Each shot will be nominated a alphabet letter, which will just basically differentiate which part of the scene we're shooting. We'll start off with A, alpha, as it's conventionally called.
Assassin, take 2.
62, besotted, take 1.
57, Pacha, take 6.
Delinquent, take 1.
Denial.
Derelict, Diablo, decomposed. Destruction, decay, take 6. A and B markers.
And the main difference between this and the ones that they have now is that now you clap it up here, clack, you know. But here, you like, it's really primitive technology because you clap it like that, but you could easily get your fingers caught in the...
The other information that I put on the slate, which is mainly for people to watch at rushes and for the editors, is a lens tag. So, for example, I'm on the 20mm for this shot, so I will put a 20mm tag on there. It's a visual effects shot, which means that there's going to be something done to it in post-production later. So I'll have a visual effects sticker on it, and that just makes it easier again for the editors to compile their stuff. We've been shooting a lot of wet weather stuff, so it's really, really hard to write in marker pen or to write anything basically when your hands are wet all the time. So we've devised this system where we put numbers and letters on the slate. Another thing we use also is a little tag, which is to indicate which stop we're on. Also the roll number. Our e-camera at the moment, which is what I'm on, is in week 5 on 285.
This is where we generate the information. So if it's wrong, it's wrong all the way down the line. And that's problematic, because we're here to make it right.
When they've got the clapper there, it is a great time to make faces at the camera.
Okay,
to make everybody laugh in dailies.
So here we are on day 27, and we're on the deck of the Venture in the middle of some fog, and those of you that know the story of King Kong will have some idea what the significance of the fog is. We're actually doing a scene that we did an animatic of. It's an interesting experience because I've lived with this animatic for 2 or 3 months now, and it's really kind of ingrained in my head.
Today, Peter is going to be shooting Jack and Anne on the Venture set, and before he can go and shoot them, we have to do a pre-visualization so that we can work out what needs to happen.
Let's just copy what these little guys do. You know, it's like you've got an acting teacher here on the screen.
Right. The basic concept behind pre-vis is a small group of people working very hard to help Pete plan out his film. He turns over the feeling of the action and the choreography he wants from the scene, and we'll go through several revisions, blocking that out in 3D animation. And then he'll start asking for shots.
All right, well, let's experiment with it and try it.
We go through that process until we have an animatic, and it basically gives everyone a really good bedrock for the sequences that are going to be in the film.
That's that crane shot we talked about doing, and that's the over-shoulder we talked about doing, crunch, and they pull into each other's arms.
It's been just a terrifically powerful tool for Pete, and has actually replaced storyboarding.
And that's exactly what you want.
Exactly what we want. I mean, yeah, you just don't want too much emotion. These little guys, I love the previs, I love it.
When we're working in previs, we don't want to spend too much time working on the human characters because they're going to be either acted out on set or animated later, and they don't define the cameras a great deal, which is what we're really focused on with previs. So we tend to keep them really simple.
You put the emotion in later, like in a computer?
Well, yeah, the computers can do anything. We can do anything later.
Yep. So don't, no emotion, no reaction.
I mean, just see that, Adrien? I mean, just look, show me that face.
The incredibly strong tools for us has been motion capture.
It's a good look.
And we're all dressing up in spandex suits and putting little balls all over us and with a bunch of infrared cameras around and put it into the computer in 3D so we can go out and act out scenes.
And it's a lot of hard work. But it's fun though. Pete's been giving us a lot of flexibility, and in fact, in some ways, we've actually designed his film for him.
Okay, now blank it out. Robotic. You can copy this. Here we go, and action.
Good, the trickiness. Oh, yes, it's good.
Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic. That's good. Excellent. That brought tears to my eyes exactly like this. It's
really?
Fantastic. Yes, no, thanks, guys.
It feels a little stiff to me.
No, but it's the modern world.
Yeah.
You've got to get used to it, Naomi. This is the future of filmmaking.
Really. Welcome to Windy Bay. Pete's nice and warm and dry in the studio. The guys are out here trying to get ready for them. This is the man-made part of Skull Island, man-made 3,000 or 4,000 years ago by an ancient culture who have since died out. As you can see from the rock forms, not natural rock forms, but hand-hewn and placed. So very much part of the culture of Skull Island. What we've got here, these are our polystyrene paving slabs. What we did was we poured concrete, we laid in layers of polystyrene, thin layers of polystyrene, shaped them to get the rock shapes.
The idea here is to lay a slurry down. We've cut out some pavers at 40mm poly. The reason we're going over it with blowtorch is to take away the hard edges so they don't break when people travel over them, and basically just get a movement in each individual paver.
And then a coat of concrete to get enough strength, and then a little paint. And a sand, but a dressing.
What I'm doing here is making the base parts of the rocks which are going up on the walls outside. This part is just the polystyrene carving. Once the rock is carved with the saber saw and knives, shaped up, which is then all glued, cut back, then that goes up on the wall. And that's really the sort of the basic building block of what we're doing here.
This is our stunt rock. What we do is we take a cast of real rock, we use that as our mould, and then we pour a foam rubber into that, and when it sets, we're left with a softer rock, but very much true to the original rock form. So rock shape, rock form, but you can roll on it and you don't break your elbows.
Windy Point. It's great to be outdoors. We've got a view of the ocean, grass underfoot, got the sky. It's really good for all the crew and cast to get away from Stone Street. People were starting to get crazy.
So here we are on shoot day 33. Interesting number because the original Kong was made in 1933. And after 32 days of shooting, it's the very first time we've shot anything outside of our studio lot.
The construction boys have been surviving out here for weeks and weeks building these sets in the wind, and just about every day it's been blowing, and the film crew came out here and it's serenity.
We're on a set, but we're also outside in the real world.
Yeah, I know, the first time here.
Combo.
We have no room in our back lot to actually put a set like this, so this was a convenient space. As you've seen on these video diaries, everyone's been working around the clock over the last week or two to get the set built. It turned out to be a little bit more elaborate, I think, than what we quite imagined it to be.
And just doing a bit more finessing, tying in some mothers and dangly things off the vines, just trying to break those up, they're not quite convincing. Just general detail.
We've got dripping water heads to give a dripping look on the set. We're doing wet downs and everything prior to shooting as well.
Of course, one of the problems with the locations is that you're at the mercy of the weather, which is why they're actually quite scary.
10 minutes ago, we were here in the sun. I was thinking of getting my jersey off. Now I'm thinking of getting my raincoat on. We've got a southerly front about to hit us. I won't need my drippers. It's all going to happen naturally. I'll be out of work. But I don't mind. Some serious rain in those clouds.
It was a beautiful morning about 5 seconds ago, wasn't it?
Holding it close, Scotty. Holding it close.
I'll protect you.
It's sunny over there.
That's right. Why don't we go over to Stone Street and check? There you go. There's no rain over there, is there? And within half an hour of arriving, it started to pour with rain. But fortunately, it was just a brief shower, and we managed to get most of our shooting done okay today.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
Yeah, that's it. That's the money.
It was good to get outside, good to get a bit of UV rays. I'm sure we're all going to be a bit healthier at the end of today after being stuck in the studio for nearly a month. And look forward to carrying on the set. The art department have done a fantastic job. A lot of people have worked very hard. And you know, it's a real credit that it's going to look so good on film.
Action!
Today is day 36 here on set, and it's not a very happy day for us.
It's disturbing. There's a guy named Gandalf who's been taking unauthorized photographs of the set and the people, and it's just freaky.
I can't believe that Gandalf would do that to me, not after everything I've done to him.
Motion pictures like to have a level of secrecy, but with Kong as King, as you've seen, we've been showing a bit of behind-the-scenes stuff.
Hello, what are you doing here? Who said you could come in here?
That doesn't seem to be good enough for one guy in particular who's going by the name of Gandalf. And he still feels the need to scurry through the bushes and creep along in the dirt. We're gonna go find.
Rach, can you just sort that out?
Yes, I can.
Thanks.
So we've got a spy. Gandalf is his name, and I just wanted to know, where do you reckon he's taking these photos from?
Stood right here. There it is.
Sorry, I'm just feeling a bit paranoid today, Andrew.
More tilt.
More so than normal.
I'm gonna go hide under the tent. Go.
Jack's very concerned about this intrusion of the privacy. I think we all should be, and I'm just a little bit worried too. It's hard to concentrate. I mean, you could be scratching your bottom or picking your nose or doing something unpleasant when he's taking photos, and it's not a good look.
Be careful, Pete. Be careful!
He's right there. We've got him. We've got him. Let's roll.
Get out, get out!
When we got here, he was gone. Just like that. This guy's quick.
Why he get him?
Do you see him?
I don't know. It's hard to say. He could be hiding in the bushes.
Blast his eyes. Blast his eyes!
FYI, Hill, a gentleman in a white here, taking pictures.
He's raising his staff!
What?
He's raising his staff.
He's raising his staff? Is he going to blast us?
I think he's got a telephoto lens.
I wonder if this is how the Balrog felt. This is pretty freaky. Okay, we're going to have to go across the descent now, Jack, and I want you to go as fast as you can, okay?
Okay.
Have you got any...
I'm going to serpentine.
Okay, all right. 3, 2, 1, go, 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 go! Run, 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 run!
End up the white.
Follow that. Go get him.
No way. Not this time, you big great.
Shall not.
Oh. Yeah, get behind us. Who's here? Oh, we were just there. Yes, you've got to be kidding me.
Why?
They always use their powers for evil.
And action.
Gonna be pissed.
So here we are on day 40. This is the parking lot where we had the venture way back at the beginning of shooting a few weeks ago, and we've now taken the ship away and we've built what's effectively a big swimming pool here. This particular scene is a swamp scene where the guys are building rafts and paddling along. Fans of King Kong will remember a very similar scene in the first film, and we're doing something along those lines.
We're shooting in the swamp today, yeah, and you know, I think we've got everything ready. It was sort of based on some concept artwork, which had been going on for quite a long time. It was really Gus's work, actually, that sort of we honed in on mostly.
Big close-up thumbs up.
It's been a very kind of difficult one to make because it's just got so many elements to it.
We're in the wet set. We'll have the best part of a metre of water in here.
We use gabion technology, which is what they use for shoring up riverbanks, basically. I mean, the thing's sitting on a car park.
Gabions, they're wire baskets full of rocks. That's the base that we used for our pond. And as you can see, it's relatively watertight and holding the 1.8 million litres of water that we've got in the pond. So hopefully it'll all stay together.
We want this to look like a swamp, and so before we start rolling today, we're going to be putting a lot of scum and slime and duckweed along the surface of it.
I'm scum guy. It's just like polystyrene swarf, like just scraped off and ground off. A couple of guys just went hard out for a couple of days, just turned themselves into snowmen. Basically, we end up with, bags of it. And then we had to colour it all in concrete mixes. And it does take a while for the colour to come through, but eventually you get... pond scum. Beautiful. All the scummy goodness of pond scum.
And of course we couldn't just go and get dirt and make it into mud. We have to make hygienic mud.
This is wallpaper paste and sterilised peat, basically.
And it's good for footprints, you know. You can make shapes with it.
So we've had to sort of develop up mud that's not going to stain the water and yet still sort of have all the other physical attributes of mud.
I tend to take this tree here. And you see where we've got all the roots, all these interesting roots here. Just rotate it round and bring it in a bit and so tangle all these roots.
We've designed this gigantic big swamp tree in the middle of the swamp.
This is our tri-tree, we call it. It's a three-piece tree. We can configure it so that it's one tree or three individual trees or one and a half trees.
10 minutes ago it was just one tree, but now we've pulled it apart into three individual pieces, and I guess over the next few days it's going to go back into one tree again, maybe.
It's weird looking at this because it doesn't really look like anything at the moment. Of course, where the blue screen is, there's going to be more swamp trees and eventually a distant jungle. And of course, we have conceptual artwork which helps us visualize what the finished product's going to look like. So we're basically just looking to get our live action bits with the actors on the rafts, and then a lot of the texture of the swamp, the overhanging trees, the mist, the wildlife in and around the swamp, all that's going to be added later in post-production with the computers.
I don't care what that guy says, eh? I can't see how you're going to make that blue screen into a jungle.
Today we're shooting a sequence where the sailors are having to shoot at something in the swamp. I can assure you it's not butterflies that they're shooting at, but they're using their guns.
I got these earplugs in, and Pete's like giving me direction.
Here he comes.
I can't hear a damn thing he says.
He's coming.
At all. I'm trying to lip read though. I think I'm getting most of it, Pete.
I'm sure he's going to use the earplugs every day now, with or without guns.
Eight guns firing, it's a lot of noise. Eye protection, ear protection, face protection.
I'll still get shot through the heart, mate, but you're to blame.
Of course, in the original movie, you may remember, the sailors were shooting at a brontosaur. I think it was probably the only carnivorous brontosaur in the world, but there's this wonderful scene of the brontosaurus tipping the raft over and staggering out of the swamp after the sailors. The original brontosaur from 1933 still survives and is very close by.
We actually have the original model of the brontosaurus here with us today. This is the stop-motion brontosaur that was built, and as you can see, it hasn't stood the test of time very well at all. And the only advantage with it being in such a bad state is it actually allows you to really study and see the way that these models were made back in 1932. A lot of it's made of steel, and the armature forms the basis of the stop-motion puppet, obviously, with the ball and socket joints. The cotton was then wrapped over the armature. You can still see the bits of string that attached it and bits of wire. They used some wire mesh netting to pad the creature out, and there's actually evidence of the football bladder that was used for the breathing. And then on top of that was finally a rubber skin. And the rubber skin is largely calcified and, in fact, disappeared. And what's left is incredibly brittle. There's actually a couple of shots at the beginning of the brontosaur scene that was done with a mechanical brontosaur head rising out of the water. It wasn't stop-motion animation like this model, and we actually have that mechanical one over here as well. This was not an animation armature. It was a little mechanical wire rig that when the head of the brontosaur comes out of the swamp, this is what rises out of the water with the water drops dripping on it. Surprisingly small scale, actually, tiny, which is sort of explains in the movie why the water seems so big and out of scale when it sort of drips from the neck of the creature. But they just made this much of it because all they needed to do was to have it sitting in the water of the swamp, you know, with the water coming up around its body. So this is all that exists of that creature. You can actually still compare it with the photos and recognize its little head. Of course, the irony is that today we don't have miniature dinosaurs anymore. They're all going to be computer generated, but these are the dinosaurs that inspired me when I was 8, 9 years old and I saw King Kong for the first time. So after 72 years, it's just amazing to think that they're sitting here right in front of us, and an amazing piece of film history.
I just found something out that really pisses me off. I looked at the website Kong is King the other night, and it has me listed as 5'4" tall, which is bullshit. Okay, I'm 5'7". And after yoga, I'm 5'7½". And I don't know who's responsible for it, but I'm going to find out today. Okay, this is a good example. We're about the same height. I want to find out what they said you, how tall they said you were. Because I believe that they said that he's like 5'8".
Yeah.
And I'm 5'4".
Yeah.
What's up with that?
Well, they, I mean, these
are weird. You really 4 inches taller than me?
Jack's not very tall. I mean, I think he wears those, you know, those heel supports. Don't tell him I told you, but I don't think he's very tall.
It's not that I want to be 5'7½". It's that I am 5'7½". 5'8", if I've just been doing yoga. I don't know how many times I have to say it.
It's pretty sad how such an innocent comment has really taken Jack's eye off the ball.
Get him. Get him. Taste of it.
What is it?
We can all have a piece of it.
I'll have a piece of it.
Sorry.
For a long time, he was giving a really good performance, but recently he's become a different man. He's lost a few inches.
Well, I don't want to affect the working atmosphere, but that's affecting my work atmosphere. That's affecting my work atmosphere. When they put lies like that in the internet for everyone to see, that affects my working atmosphere.
I mean, okay.
The grips have just brought you this.
Oh, cool.
There you go. They should just jump up and sort things out.
Anyway, and apparently
that doesn't help me. That doesn't make me feel better.
No, I think this 5'4 thing's pretty accurate, isn't it?
I reckon it's pretty accurate because I'm 5'10.
And even if he's not 5'4, he acts like someone who's 5'4, which is really probably what they're referring to.
Okay. Well, I'll be in my trailer until this is rectified.
All right.
I do yoga, you know. It stretches the tendons and the muscles and the bones. Everyone knows that. Makes you taller.
I've been thinking a lot about it.
Yeah.
And I don't know if these are period, but I really think these would be good for my character.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, I mean, so long as we don't see them, I guess it doesn't really matter.
Okay.
Can we make it like your trousers are long and your trousers drag on the ground so they hide the shoes?
Yeah. No, I don't really. It's just the feel of them. I feel more Carl Denham when I wear these. So.
Is it extra 2 inches that important to you?
It's not the inches. It has nothing to do with inches. It has to do with the feel of the, for the good of the film. Thank you, though. I'm glad that you're okay with it. That's Carl Denham in a nutshell. You can laugh, but I think these are right for the character.
Absolutely.
It's not really about if they look how they look. It's more about how I feel.
Right.
And they do make me feel
more.
And they
make you feel like Carl.
Yeah.
Yeah. Carl the filmmaker.
Thank you. I'm glad you see things my way.
Sorry.
It's okay.
Sorry, Mr. Black.
No problem at all. How are you?
I'm fine.
Good to see you.
Oh, yeah.
Just remember, everybody, sense of speed and urgency, please. And action.
And cut. That's good. Now Jack's so much better.
Hey, Jack.
Yeah?
It's good, mate. Much better.
Oh, good.
We're just going to do one more for luck.
I felt good on that one. Good.
So it's day 48 and we're in the jungles of Skull Island. Not particularly spectacular on set, this is like a kit set jungle, a build your own jungle. But of course the real jungle is going to be appearing in the blue screen, that's where all the spectacular stuff is. And you'll have a look at those little orange markers on the blue screen, they're critical to the process.
Right, well that's because there are holes in the screen. And they're just to cover them and they couldn't find any blue gaffer tape.
Well actually they're not dots, they're squares.
It's to keep a guy named Malcolm Angel employed.
Track markers. What we're doing is creating a virtual camera which mimics the movement of the real camera, and we use that for any computer generated portions of the shots.
So with the computers tracking the camera movement, the combination of miniatures and real footage is going to be used to create the jungles. Jeremy Bennett and Gus Hunter, two of our conceptual artists, have been working for well over a year on creating looks for our Skull Island jungles.
Once the artwork's approved, it goes to either art department to build the set, or it then goes down to ultimately miniatures who will produce the sort of mid-ground elements and sometimes the background elements before you hit the digital matte painting in the deep distance. The beauty of working in Photoshop here using photographic elements is that the amount of information we can convey in the paintings proves to be very, very helpful to Alex Funky.
When we start, the production illustration just gives us the basics, how big things are, where they are, what kind of trees there are, things of that kind. But it also contains all the details that Peter has seen and has developed maybe over a number of paintings, things that he really wants to see. The beam of light coming through here, the fact that the distant trees are gradually fading out into the smoke, how much smoke you see here compared to how much smoke you see here, what kind of plants are growing on this little rocky section. All these things we can get just from looking at this painting.
One thing with conceptual art is that often the art looks amazing, but you can never actually recreate it on film. So I was very determined that our conceptual designs for our jungle were actually achievable, because, you know, I didn't want art that got us all excited and then we couldn't actually
get that look on film. So earlier this year, we instigated a series of tests where we took the art that Jeremy and Gus had done, and we really tried to recreate the look of the jungles on 35mm film.
There's the painting of the log they're working from. Here's the real log. Very, very small, 20th scale. So what we had to do after the live action was shot of these guys walking over the sandbags was to match the contours of that ramp to the contours of this 20th scale miniature log. So all these little ups and downs are actually little ups and downs in the sandbag pile. Now there's a lot of other layers. If you look over the back there, this is not the actual relationship. There's another piece, that's a mid-ground piece. It's a bit of tree, it's this piece right here. That's coming down there. So this, we actually shot this in a series of layers. The reason being, we want to put different amounts of smoke in it to make it look like it's getting further and further away. So it's a very evolutionary process and a very exciting one.
Once each piece is shot, then that is scanned in digital and handed over to the compositor. What we're essentially doing is trying to build all those layers and try and recreate Jeremy and Gus's vision as close as possible.
So we actually have quite evocative test shots that won't be in the movie, but they certainly represent the type of shots that we're looking to achieve in the finished film. So here we are on day 51, and it's our first day of shooting the Skull Island Wall. It's going to be a spectacular set. As in the original film, I wanted the village and the wall to have been built by the hand of some ancient civilization. And of course, the Skull Island population that occupy it today are not the people that built this. The people that built these structures have long since disappeared for whatever reason. Probably something to do with dinosaurs and big gorillas, I suspect. And it's now inhabited by a much less sophisticated group of people, and they are the people that obviously take Anne and sacrifice her to Kong. Even though this set is very close to our studio base, just the fact that it is a location up on a hill, it poses all sorts of complications for the unit, and we have a tremendously hard-working unit team whose job it is to make sure that we can just show up, get out of our cars, walk on the set and start shooting. And for me that sounds simple, but for everybody else it's been an enormously difficult logistical and planning exercise.
So now we're on King Kong instead of Lord of the Rings, and we're still setting up again.
The responsibilities of a unit location manager are sort of mainly would start with locations, as a sense of setting up the location for the crew to come in and work. Basically, when we started on this location, it was a field. It just had grass, a bit of gorse, a few little shrubby bushes around the place. So we come in with some graders, we took up all the topsoil, and then we brought in a whole lot of base course. All the grass had to go, and we had to get all this stuff here, and it's just shingle and dirt, really. Just looks like a normal shingle road now, but it was a nice green pasture at one stage. That enabled the art department and that to bring all their machinery in and pop the containers up, do all the scaff work and get the set ready. Once we start filming, the unit's in charge of looking after the crews.
Today we've got 4 shuttle drivers, which might increase to 6, moving crew from a parking area to the location, because there's diddly squat room on the location.
Since 6 o'clock this morning, half a dozen of our transport boys have been down here, wrapping all the trucks, getting them all warmed up, and travelling them back to Crawford. The camera is one of our vital trucks that we have to get up on site first, because we need to have it powered up for the batteries.
This is us.
Up top there, we had to sort of do some more grader work and flatten out some of the hill. Sort of, it was a bit of a slope, and we had to sort of flatten it all out and make a big space up there, which is about the size of a rugby field, maybe a bit smaller for the caravan park up there.
That's Steve Harvey. He's in charge of maintaining and setting up our caravans.
When we bring units up here, like the campers and the swagmen and the trailers, we've got to water them up, power them up, make sure they're basically all go. But on a site like this, you've really got to take care of the sanitary side of things, obviously the toilets and things like that. It's just home away from home, really, just like going camping at Christmas.
So the actors all sort of hang out up there, sort of keep away from us. Nice little hideaway for them. It's the best spot on set, to be honest. Power for the site comes from that power line. It sort of runs down. We've got a temporary box here to set up for the power. There's our 63 phase, which feeds most of the construction site. We will be drawing too much power for this site, for this thing to handle, so we've got generators to help sort of spread the load a bit.
We've got, in this one at this stage, four generators split into four corners of the location, and we're basically just providing lighting power. Whenever anything else crops up, we'll jump in and provide them whatever else they need.
The tents are set up for two reasons. There's a couple of big tents over there. The far one is the weather tent, which is for getting the native extras ready. The other tent is for catering for the crew.
We've got 400 people, cast and crew, to feed today. For that we need two catering trucks, infrastructure of power, water. We've also got a coffee truck on location so people can die and live on flat whites.
Welcome to the coffee truck.
If it wasn't for the unit department, then the crew wouldn't have somewhere to eat, they wouldn't have power or water, the set wouldn't be able to be built. Yeah, hey, we're the backbone of this whole industry.
So that's the end of this video diary. Now, we're going to keep these going. We're really having a lot of fun making them. But we actually thought it might be quite good to send out an invitation to all of you folk who watch these. If there's anything that you want to know about the production of the film, you know, King Kong is obviously what we're making, but either about Kong in particular or about filmmaking in general, why don't you let the Kong is King website know about it? And we can carry on doing these video diaries and start incorporating some specific answers to questions that you may have or things that you want to learn about. Fire in the questions. We're here and we'll read them and we'll see what we can do. So it's day 53. We're still shooting on our Skull Island village set. It's interesting some of the things you have to deal with filmmaking, and one of the things you may not know about is that the studio often arranges visits of press while you're filming. It gives the press an opportunity to visit the set, to describe what they see on the set, to interview the actors and while they're actually working. And today we're hosting a visit of a group of international press, and it's fun to see them down here in New Zealand, and they're having a look around and you'll be able to get to meet some of them. How are you guys, right?
Well, thank you. Nice to see you. How are you?
They're just really excited to be here. A lot of them have travelled from Europe and Germany and Switzerland.
And I'm very happy, you know, to have travelled to the far side of the world to follow it. And I look forward to writing an article for the people in Little Denmark, you know, about this great production.
We try to get them onto set as often as we can, which can be quite tricky. We work closely with the ADs to see where we should and shouldn't stand.
Going on the set for about 3 minutes before we're told to get off because we're in Naomi Watts' sight line, but I'm sure we'll get another chance to go back on. Look, it's exciting. Makes me want to be an extra for about 10 minutes.
When we do interviews, when we manage to get actors, we try to get them to commit to about a 20-minute interview, which they will do with all 16 journalists.
They gathered you all, and I feel like I should do a sermon.
Sermon for the mouth, I guess.
So you're Jack, right?
I'm Jack.
So what kind of dude is Jack?
Obviously, the journalists just love getting an opportunity to speak to the actors and hear about their experiences with Peter. And at the moment, the questions seem to be quite general.
Jack, can we start, please, by getting your take on the whole King Kong thing as a kid when you first saw it there?
Well, I think I saw the remake first.
So when did you see the original, as it were?
The original? I saw it when it came out. When was that? 70?
No, the 1933.
Oh, the original.
Yeah, the original.
None of the journalists have read the script. They all know that the movie's based on the 30s version, so they have something to reference.
That's completely different to the 1976 version, where all the villagers live behind the wall.
Yes.
Okay.
Have you got a special question that you want to ask them? Do you want to get in there in front of all
this? No, not by now.
You're just going to sit back and listen. Within a group of 20 or, you know, 16 journalists that we've got at the moment, you've probably got about four or five journalists that ask the main group of questions.
I will ask to Naomi Watts, how does it feel to be eventually compared with somebody like Jessica Lange? Or to the other girl of the 30s movies.
And fortunately for this group, they're actually a really smart group of people, so they've asked really good questions.
Why is King Kong timeless?
Timeless. Yeah. Why?
Why? What in your eyes, everyone will have their own take on what makes it timeless and magical.
Timeless?
Sorry. I'm He's Scottish. He's a foreigner. while.
I know.
We have a shot at a shot. Yeah.
As soon as I leave here, I'm going for an elocution or electrocution.
Bloody need.
Because I said tambourine, and you said yes.
No.
It's a tough to have a whole lot of journalists together because everyone's looking for their own angle for a story and everyone's in exactly the same situation, listening to exactly the same words from everyone.
Can you tell us about the excitement you're clearly feeling as your Kong, the beast you're creating, is developing? And I mean, and you're quite cunningly keeping from us, obviously, for very obvious reasons.
We have noticed.
Well, we have. No, to be completely honest with you, as of today, I haven't seen Kong myself.
I don't know if you have known the film called Godzilla, but we do this like King Kong versus Godzilla in Japan.
King Kong, the king of all monsters, even better than Godzilla. He's stronger and smarter than Godzilla. Godzilla's a stupid lizard. King Kong is almost a man, a giant man. Sasquatch, if you will.
The whole day has been one independent surprise after another, as far as I'm concerned. So, but yeah, it's been great just to be on the set and see the scope of the thing. I think it's very impressive.
It's this impressive Great Wall I just am looking at right now. You know, it's so amazing. You know, it must have cost a lot of $1 million.
So they're really just here to soak up the environment, get a sense of what filming is like, get a sense of what Peter Jackson's like as a director, how the actors like to work, a little bit of the story, but it's really a preliminary feeling out how the movie is and working out what kind of coverage they want to do and how they want to use their interviews in the future.
It'll probably start covering next month.
Okay.
I think I have a deadline of next week or something to get the first thing out. So, because people in New Zealand are, you know, they have vested interest in all of this. They take all this Peter Jackson's work very personally, and so I think they're going to be wanting to follow along the whole process of the thing.
Thanks, Peter.
Thank
nice
you.
To see you.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Thanks, Peter.
Okay, yeah.
Nice to meet you again.
Yeah. See you.
Yeah. Thanks, mate.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Okay. Right. Back to the tents.
So it's the end of day 58 today, and we've been ploughing through your requests. This is just a few of them, but they're the ones that specifically wanted to know about the art department and the on-set art department and how they get ready for a day's shooting. So for Anthony, Mark, Jordan, Barb, and all the others that wanted to know about the art department, we've had our cameras following our team over the last couple of days. Yesterday we were on the Skull Island set, and today we're back on the jungles of Skull Island. So they're two very different days, and we thought we'd just follow the art department around for a couple of days and show you what happened.
You may think that the art department builds a set and that's it, but that's not it. We're constantly revising sets, building new sets, always just trying to stay ahead of the shooting crew. And of course on the day, the shooting crew, they get to the set needs to be redressed, turned around, and that's why we have a on-set art department.
The responsibility of the on-set art director and his team is to make sure that the set is exactly as Peter wants it.
Maybe another one here, so that, because that's a step that they're obviously going to come up.
He just adjusts things on the day so that it suits Peter and what he wants to shoot.
What Peter wants is one of these skeletons over here, dressed in the foreground of this wide angle as the heroes come through the set here. So we're just working out the lens size and we can build something that works for the shot.
The art department, or camera department, is a very important member of the team. They create all this stuff and then we just turn up and go, mate, get that out of here, will you? And they just take it away. It's fantastic.
So you see what they're doing here? They've removed all of this because we're walking about here with a steady cam. And then when we're back over there, it's all going to have to go back in. And no one's going to say please or thank you. It's just the job he took. What can you say?
We have, you know, standby chippy, standby props, standby painter, standby green, so that anything that needs little repairs on the way through, or if paint gets knocked off anything, they would fix it up.
If we have to move a whole bunch of rocks around, they tend to get knocked a wee bit, so it's kind of just damage control, really, so that's nothing too detailed, but just to make sure there's no big patches of white showing,
spot there,
for example.
One of the things he really likes is to dress to camera.
Yeah, now, there is the other choice. This is actually Murray, but there is Wayne, who's on the other ruin, and I think we should get Wayne.
Wayne?
And just see if he's better than Murray.
Murray's a bit stiff, is he?
Well, Wayne's all curled up, and it might look more, you know, more of a ceremonial death rather than someone who looks like he's just been shot and left lying there.
So, Wayne, you finally made it. Pete likes him, so we're going to poke him in the spot where Murray is and see how he performs. He's happy. Yay! He might have been a bit bleached from the sun. We'll probably do a bit of treatment on him to knock him back and dust him up and gravel him up to make him look like he's been here for some time.
Can you hear now?
Vietnamese torture tie him up like that and they untie him, they can't stand up.
It's just a bit of masking.
Well, I was told to take these ones right up top.
Up some rib shape,
yeah. Oh, you got to love that, son. Nice.
Are these going to look funny lined up like that? I reckon they'll look quite ceremonious.
Ceremonial in the extreme. It's got it.
So they're busy. They're not just sitting there looking at it. They're usually very, very busy. And all the ground dressing, all the shells, all the detritus from their eating, which is mostly fish-based.
We'll walk on them and break them and just sort of do whatever it needs to make them the right colour or texture. We just sort of work on them offset and then throw them on. And if it's still not right, the onset crew will do it.
We use various different types of sand depending on the set that we're working on. If it's a dark set, you know, we'll go for a darker sand, just whatever really suits the part. And right here we have these larger rocks. We also have painted these. We paint them with a blue base and then a black overcoat to get this color that we have now. They were these here, and that's the difference after the paint. What we do is kind of intermingle all of them together to get the visual we're looking for, more of a natural look where people can walk by and not see that it's been placed there. So we also get what's called mingy-mingy and such things like that from the bush around the area around here.
Since we're not shooting on location, everything from the largest rock wall to the tiniest leaf needs to be built.
Mount Crawford was really physical, heavy, hard work, like lugging rocks and sand and stuff around. And not hardly any greenery.
We have a huge nursery out the back that we built especially for this movie.
Which is located just directly behind the studio. And you can see Kong stage directly behind me.
Because you can only leave them in a studio for a certain amount of time before they start to look a bit sick. So you have to take them back out into the nursery and bring in new ones and feed them up again and make them healthy.
Because film sets aren't really the kindest places to bring plants into, just with all the lights and extra feed that are around on a crew. So you're better off going for more native sort of plants.
A good 20 different varieties of plants, and all those are living specimens grown in bags right here. And then when we put them on set, we make sure to keep them well watered. Besides that, the moss would be the other major live specimen.
Lots and lots of living mosses, but we have a bit of fun with some synthetic things as well.
Our number one fake moss is this fun fir, and it just comes in mats. We burn it with propane to get it curly, and it actually gives a really real look.
Well, Wellington's pretty good for beech forests. Most of it is very light, so what we have to do is paint it all back so it doesn't ping out in the lights, so you're not getting lots of spots of white, which will look a lot like all this polystyrene that's here, which we have to paint back as well.
Taking photographs on set is probably one of the most important things that the on-set crew do for them and for us off-set, because it's for continuity. You may have to go back to that same set or maybe rebuild it 2 months later, and it's amazing what you forget without a photograph.
Everywhere you go, you need to know what it was so that you just, you know, make those wonderful continuity mistakes that people are looking for all the time.
I've just taken a photo of the skeleton down there and the dressing, so if we do have to return here, we can match how it was. And yeah.
Stay down here, Jack.
Here we all are.
Yeah, not the butt hole, Jack.
I wanted to touch it, see how real it was.
Very real. I think it will be available for hire at the weekend.
Well, as you can see, the art department's constantly in motion, and it's time to move on to the next set.
So hopefully that gives you a bit more of an idea of the art department. And we're going to keep going through the questions. There's lots of good ideas here, so we're inspired. We'll keep these production diaries coming, keep the questions coming. But we've already got a few ideas for the next week or two. So look forward to seeing you all again soon.
Don't let him in.
Exhaustion and stress with rising tension. Cut. I'm Lewis Olivares. I do video playback. What I mainly do is record everything and play it back for Peter to check the action and make sure, you know, everything's working fine. But I do a lot of playback for other people as well, mainly the actors.
My problem is I'm a compulsive overactor, and sometimes it's helpful for me to see playback just to see how bad it looks when I overact. For instance, can we see take one, please? Lewis? Everyone's good, everyone's real, look at everyone's face. Everyone's on the same page, right? What's going on here? What's that guy doing? What movie is he in? No, what's the grimace? Okay.
I'm gonna show her your redemption.
So sometimes you need to watch playback. That's all I'm saying.
After each take, pretty much, they go back to the monitors and Lewis play this, Lewis play that. We get a lot of requests from Jack, Andy, Adrien.
Hey, Lewis, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Could you please play a TA-25 for me?
Definitely.
Thank you.
Lewis, I'm gonna need to see TA-26 right away, please.
I'm watching something.
What are you watching?
I'm watching TA-25.
Screw TA-25. We don't need to see that.
I just wanna watch TA-25.
Man, if you have Jack Black in your cast, you'll never get to the monitor.
Now, look, you can all watch the monitor. There's no need to squabble. Are you squabbling for, like, the best position? Maybe you could have a moment of togetherness and on your...
So I told you, Jack's a problem.
At the beginning of this job, a lot of us had integrity as actors, and as the job has kind of gone on, we realised that we're all suffering from a syndrome known as monitor-watching syndrome.
Now, don't get mad, don't freak out. I'm not going to go look at playback. But honestly, right now, I want to see playback Let me just finish.
I do too.
More than I've ever wanted to see playback in my life.
And it's a weakness that we've finally today admitted that it is a problem for us all. And so we're trying to help each other in the group by talking about it.
I told myself it was just fun. I'd just like to do it for fun.
I told myself that I only did it when the other guys would do it. But I found myself watching the monitor when I'm alone.
Honestly,
I haven't looked at it all day.
Can I get a word in? When you wait for Pete to say, why don't you come over and take a look? It's always to look at how stinky you are. It's never to come look at how good you did. It's always, no.
But that's
why don't you come over here and check this out? That's the only time you should look
at
playback.
That's the only time.
Is when you are sucking.
When you are sucking.
All right. Packed. Playback only when you're sucking.
Absolutely.
Your hair looked good.
It's all about vanity, and it takes a lot of time. We could be shooting more scenes, we could be in character for longer, but no, what do? We come off, we shoot the scene, we all file straight past the monitor, and we just basically wank off watching ourselves.
Waste time.
Let me just say this, though.
I like to masturbate. It feels good on my penis. And it also feels good because if you don't, you get overload. I don't know if that's an exact parallel to watching the monitor. But if I don't watch the monitor, I do start to feel blue balls.
What are you doing? Hey, what are you doing? What are you talking
about? No, I'm just...
What are you...
I'm just waiting for... I'm waiting for playback.
We haven't shot the scene.
What?
We haven't shot anything yet.
What do you mean we haven't?
We've not shot the scene yet. What are you doing, man? Come on.
I'm sorry. I thought.
Come on, man.
Okay, I'm sorry. We're having struggles because we all believe different things. Jack is convinced that he can help himself by watching himself on the monitor, which I think is the workings of a sick, crazed mind. What's a director for? You should trust a man of stature like Peter Jackson. Do you need to watch yourself? Do you, Jack?
Do you?
Look, I'm admitting it's a sickness. It's an addiction.
So this is, you know, a watershed between real acting from the soul and mugging for the camera.
Okay, first of all, Andy Serkis is not innocent in this. I've seen him do lots of monitor watching.
Right, I'm having a conversation with you. I've got my lines, but actually I'm watching myself here.
But you're supposed to be, like, looking at what? Looking at King Kong's over there? But instead you're looking at yourself.
King Kong's here, okay? Now this is my reaction to Kong.
Ah!
That's good.
Try it, man. It works.
That's good acting.
Sometimes when you do watch the monitor, you get that stare going.
What stare?
No, but look. This last setup, we've all achieved not watching the monitor for this entire setup, apart from a couple of two or three weak, sick people. Sick that we have to help.
Adrien?
Evan. Oh, Adrien, yeah, you did fail.
Can I see?
Look, this is the one.
What the hell?
What? Oh, shit.
Oh, God.
No. What? No. Oh, God.
No.
Run,
please,
quick.
Jack.
No, Jack.
Wait,
please.
No. I wasn't looking.
It's fine. I'm not watching it. I'm watching it for you. I'm watching it for you, man.
What are you doing here? This is a meeting of people who no longer watch.
Maybe it's an intervention.
Look at that. That's magic. Yeah, that was good.
That was a good one.
That was worth watching.
Absolutely.
It can be a useful tool, but I think with these guys, it's become an addiction.
These guys. He's not a part of the thing now.
What's the point? What are you
doing? I'm doing it to make a point.
What's the point?
Won't you just trust me on this one?
What point? What are you
just
talking
about?
Just
trust me.
Get over here. Don't let him in.
We gotta get him back to the trailer park. Back to trailer park right away. Right away.
They're all mad.
The thing is, I realize that now. I'm pretty well, sorry.
It's okay.
I realize that the whole shoot, I've succumbed to it, really. And I just kind of wish I could go back to day one. And I just feel like I really have been a fraud now.
Quick, someone get his bag. I'll get your bag.
Don't worry. I'll get your bag. Come on.
Don't do it.
The whole gang are coming back.
Take him his bag.
You're just making fun of me now.
No. We're not making fun of you. I'm sorry that I said it was you.
Okay.
Really, I didn't mean to say you guys, because it's my problem, too. And, you know, it really makes me feel awful. I feel awful about it.
But seriously, will you stop and rewind that? I need to see how that works. Hey, Lewis, are you there? Oh, great. Stead thinking you're not on the television.
So here we are, it's day 62, and we're shooting on the shoreline of Skull Island, which is our wet set in the back lot here. And this is another one of our requests from the viewers, if you like. And this one was requested by a lot of people. A surprising number of people actually wanted to know about the cameras, the type of cameras that we're using and how that they work.
This is a 35mm motion picture camera, and today it's got a 32mm lens on and a filter which is an 81EF, which is going to make the daylight slightly cool because this is a pre-dawn sequence. And we're filming right behind you.
So for Hines and for Brian and Keith and Mark and Philip and Peter and many other people, this video diary is going to focus on our cameras.
Now what happens is the light comes through the lens, through here, it takes off. And what happens is it hits that mirror
and that mirror spins around like that 24 times a second. And when it hits the mirror, the light travels up here into the eyepiece so the operator can see. And then when it only spins around half, it exposes the film, and that's where we get our pictures. This is the first shot of the day.
164 Alpha Take 1, A marker, guide track.
Mark.
B marker.
Set.
Camera reload.
This is loading the camera, reading the camera. If you look in here, you can see a little gap in there, that's the camera gate, and this is where the film gets exposed. And then what happens is these pins come out, they're called the registration pins. They hold the film steady, and the film's been exposed, and then pull down the pause, come down again, and that happens 3-4 times a second.
This is an LCS, which stands for Lens Control System, which is essentially just a remote focus device which enables me to step away from the camera and pull focus remotely without actually needing to be anywhere near the camera.
If you can imagine, you've got a manual camera at home and you're taking a photo, you've got to focus it up, but in this situation with a motion picture camera, actors may be moving or the camera might be on a dolly and it'll be tracking in and moving, so the focus needs to be adjusted constantly during the shot, and that's what the focus puller does. The other things focus puller does is they're responsible for the camera, like this little 235.
This is the Aricam Light, one of our cameras that we're using. It's a lightweight camera, great for handheld. Now I've got your exposed film counter. This is your raw stock, so that's the amount of footage remaining. And reset that by the reset button. Over here we have city tape, which isn't actually part of the camera, it's just an accessory. That's like a digital tape measure. The ultrasound out comes out to the front of these two horns. Down here we have the frames per second. That's all. Chains were there, 1-40 frames, and it's your on-off button.
We have three cameras on this setup. We have a 65mm camera, which Simon Harding is operating, which is filming a reverse of Naomi to Adrien. We have Reese on a 40mm, filming a slightly wider shot of the same activity. And I am on a 20mm lens, which is a wide-angle lens.
These are different focal lengths for different shots that you may want to compose depending on the drama of the situation. The higher the number, the longer the lens. For instance, if you shot from the same spot, the same subject with a 50, and then change to 100, you'd have a much tighter shot.
Whatever you've got a 28 and just open it up. It might be too wide, but 28 will be good. Yeah, 28 will be good. Yeah. 28,
try that. 28, yeah.
There's no reason going
tighter. 40 to 28, going wider. This is the T-stop, the aperture. T-stop's measured once the light's travelled through the lens, whereas in an f-stop in a stills camera, the light's measured before it comes through the lens. And this is the zoom.
Oh,
obviously
yeah.
It moves around there.
This maybe this.
Tight end there, 290. And out to 24. And this is your focus scale here. And that's it.
Magazine goes to the film holder.
These are 1,000-foot mags. The other ones were a bit smaller, and they're 400-foot mags. The reason we have 400 and 1,000 is because the
caps on.
The 1,000-foot mags are very heavy, so 1,000-foot is production mode, 400-foot is for handheld.
One magazine, 400 feet of unexposed. This one here we have 350 of exposed neg.
400 feet would have 4 minutes of shooting on it. That's at 24 frames, which is the normal real time. We can go high speed up to 150 frames, which means this would last 60 seconds at the most.
And cut. That's good. That's great. We can check that. Thank you. Good.
Thank you very much, everybody. We'll check that.
During the shot, you can get a bit of dirt build up or a scratch. What we check for is just see that it's clear, basically, and that there's no damage. no damage to the film, and that way we can move on to the next shot.
Thanks, Carol. Gates clear.
And thank you, everybody. That is a shooting range.
I heard that Viggo slept with his sword to get into character, so I sleep with my camera. Don't touch my camera.
So here we are on day 66. We're in the Opera House in Wellington, which is an old theatre, which is pretending to be an old theatre in the middle of New York sometime in 1933. But that's not why we're talking to you at the moment. We're actually doing the first web diary sequel. Now, the other day we did cameras, and then that sparked a lot of inquiries. Heinz, Al, Andrew, and a bunch of other people said, oh, well, that's nice, but what happens to the film after it leaves the camera? And so we thought, okay, well, let's just shoot a sequel to last week's web diary. And so we're now going to follow that roll of film. It's B432, and we're going to follow its journey from the time it leaves the camera all the way through the system, so you can see what happens to that roll of film.
The journey of the life of roll B432 starts on set during the shoot. This roll, incidentally, is a scene between Colin Hanks and John Sumner at Skull Island Co.
Yeah, very nice. Thank you.
Thank you. And act.
And
camera reload.
Good.
Once PDL's cut, the magazine containing our roll B432 is then taken off the camera and put into a case by the camera assistant and is then taken to the camera truck.
It comes back to the dark room where I download it and scan it and send it off with a runner to the lab where it gets processed.
Hey mate, how far away are we?
I'm so ready.
Here you go, enjoy them.
Yeah, I'll go on, bro.
I've just brought in these exposed rolls of film. So the process is we'd grab the net, load it in total darkness, and run it through the machine. While that's happening, we're preparing for it throughout the rest of the lab.
Once that's finished in here, the negative is cleaned, then it is printed. So then you have the negative, and you have an unexposed print. And then the negative is transferred in Telecine. The print is processed and then screened by Lynn and I in the lab theatre.
I look at the colour in here, in the theatre, and then go around to Telecine and just check, make sure that everything is looking pretty much the same.
This goes on to the Telecine itself, and this is what converts the optical film into a video signal. The spirit's called, call the spirit, the Telecine. It's scanning at 2,000 lines all the time and can actually feed out to high definition and to standard definition tapes
and to the Avid hard drive at all at the same time, so we don't have to record anything afterwards.
The Avid is what digitises the material for editorial, and then that's all dispatched on a small firewire drive.
See ya.
It comes back to us on a firewire drive, and we have these rather nice little Bond, James Bond cigarette cases, which is a 40 gigabyte firewire drive, so the media comes back to us on that. And that media, which is a copy of the film, is really what we deal with mostly. So this media is picture only. We get sound as a media file from another source. We put the two together. We break all of those, every shot in the film down. We add lots of information. We send that on to the editors.
We normally get the footage the next day after it's been shot. It takes sort of a day for it to go through the whole process of being developed, put onto videotape, ingested into the Avid, logged, broken up, sunk with the sound that was recorded separately. And then finally, about a day later, we get it in our system and can go through it and edit the footage.
So when it comes time to view the film that we shot, it gets called rushes or dailies. I think that's a British-American thing. I think Americans call them dailies and the Brits or New Zealanders call them rushes. But They are usually viewed in the cinema, although what I've taken to doing now is to watch them on DVD. Usually there's so much footage that rather than sit in the cinema for, you know, a couple of hours at the end of each day, Andrew Lesney, our DP, and a few other people watch just one take from each shot to make sure they're happy with the lighting, which is obviously where Andrew's interest is. For me, I ultimately want to watch all the takes because that's where the performance comes from, and the easiest way for me to do that is to have the dailies on a DVD. And then I can watch them at my leisure, like I'm here on set at the moment, and I can just pop the DVD in, which is our dailies, and I can just have a look at it at my leisure as I'm sitting here working during the day. I can check up on what we did yesterday or the day before and make sure that I'm happy with everything. I also get a copy of these to take home with me. It's a good way to look at the dailies because I can just jump from take to take. I can, you know, find my way around. There's menus and can just pull up a particular bit. If there's something I want to look at, if I want to just double check that we've got a moment, then it's a great way to access and find things. So thank heavens for DVDs. Day 68, and we're inside the Wellington Opera House. But of course, in the movie, we're in the middle of New York. And a lot of you have asked about New York Art Department and conceptualizing and how we're going about creating the city of New York in New Zealand. So people like Mark, Charles, Scott, Adrien, Sarah, Jesse, Chris, Ignaz. Ignaz was a funny name, never mind. I'm sure you're happy with that name. So for those people, we thought we'd just do a sort of a catch-up on where things are with New York today.
It's a huge kind of thing to take on. So, you know, we've done a lot of work in sourcing period photographs and really studying them as hard as we possibly can, you know, just to do with architectural detail, to do with signage.
The rubber flow ride, the new Watson rubber flow stabilisers. I mean, that stuff's great because you can't make that stuff up, eh? It's just, like, really archaic and cool, and that's a good, nice, big, lit, bloody billboard thing.
We've even studied the amount of people per block, if you like, because back then, I mean, it was one of the most heavily, densely populated cities in the world, so we were sort of catering for that sort of amount of extras. Whew, I mean, it's just full of detail. So part of the research was, you know, a very quick visit there.
We got up at about 5 in the morning, and the nice folks at the Empire State Building took us on this tour up to the very top.
We're in the Empire State Building. March the 4th, 2004.
I really wanted to have a look at what it was like to be on the top of the Empire State Building, and I wanted Naomi to look at it too, because obviously in the movie that's where she's going to be at the end of the film.
This is what we're going to have to look at. First few states in New Zealand, you're going to be doing stuff here.
Good wind reference we're getting here.
We're getting a good feeling. It's really important that New York to me is not stylized or anything other than the absolute realistic New York, and we're going to a lot of detail to try to be as historically accurate with the buildings as possible.
There has been considerable differences between present-day New York and 1933 New York, a lot of which is what we see is the amount of high-rise buildings that have been added to the city. One of the things we find is that the skyline in 1933 New York is a lot different than what we see today.
And then, of course, there's a big research thing. We found, looking at a lot of New York sets that have been done before, that they appeared quite clean, and we wanted to make ours gritty. You know, we're set in the 1930s in the depth of the Depression. It's a gritty story, and we really wanted to give it a lot of texture.
You know, conceptualising started about a year ago with some artwork that was done. Jeremy Bennett did an exercise of really conceptualising more of a colour palette and a visual look for New York, not so much the technical building-by-building side of things, but just what it could look like mood-wise.
This is the first day of the shoot in 3 weeks and 4 days. 3 weeks and 4 days. first day of the shoot. So I guess, actually, in some respects, this is almost the priority.
A titter of nervous laughter.
This is obviously a different New York than what I saw and experienced. It's a lot grimier, dirtier, smoggier. You know, certainly the first portion here that we see in the docks. It's not the New York that Mayor Giuliano would want to portray to the world. All of these illustrations are done in Photoshop, and the beauty of that is so we can build up, you know, really quite detailed and complete illustrations which do capture the essence and the flavour of the time.
A lot of people are thinking that New York in New Zealand is kind of a crazy notion. Why don't we go to New York City and shoot it for real? But of course, the reality is that shooting in modern day New York as 1933 is almost impossible. I mean, the city is hard to shoot in at the best of times, and to actually dress large sections of it and control large sections for a period film is very, very difficult. So what we're doing is we're building a backlot in the Hutt Valley.
This is Times Square, and as you can see behind me, this is the subway. And I'll blue screen the bottom of it, I suppose, to give the illusion that you're going down the stairs into a subway.
But then this later on becomes Herald Square. We've put another facade on the building there. We change it around a little, becomes Herald Square, and across the street we have Macy's.
I think this street here is 46th Street, if I'm correct. Could be wrong.
Well, there's Broadway somewhere, and then there's Fifth Avenue, then there's, yeah, and it all, I think there's Broadway, and then Fifth Avenue, and there's 44th Avenue, and heaps of, there's so many street names around here, mate, you can't, we don't know. Yeah, you get lost in New York.
So all that exists in one complex of streets and avenues. And there is also going to be a certain amount of set turnarounds we do.
I tell you what, that's a good corner to have the big wraparound awning on the corner too, the sign. It's good to have that detail on it. I mean, you probably should throw it in there. You know what
sure.
I mean? For other scenes, we can just
pull it off.
We can just have it off.
Yeah, because it does turn into that Empire State Building.
Yeah, so it'll have a square corner on it. It'll have a square corner, but once you put the awning and the wraparound,
it changes
the feel of it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So it's probably worth doing that.
And the main thing that we wanted to get is that we wanted New York to look like it wasn't a backlot, you know, and I guess in doing so we're relying a heck of a lot on computer graphic extensions.
The buildings are only built to a certain height on set location, and digitally we construct the buildings within the computer, apply to different materials and textures to make the building look realistic, and continue that on also throughout the distance of the street. So for a shot that may be constructed within a specific location, we may have to digitally extend the street all the way down to the horizon. It's an actual 3D model that's built down to the finest level. We can fly around the entire city. Any place he wishes to go within the city, he can take his camera down onto that street. We have constructed everything throughout the entire island.
So the digital effects are just as powerful a tool these days as physical building. And as you can see, our New York is really going to be a very careful blend of the two. Our shooting in New York happens in January, February next year. And so around that time, we'll be able to expand on this early look and show you a lot more detail about how we're going about it.
Hey, I'm Steve. We're at the Wellington Zoo today with the second unit. So yeah, we're just having a pretty cool cruisey day at the zoo.
Mostly, it's this morning's been a study of culinary habits. Here comes somebody up the way.
Yeah.
Fascinating, it walks. Uh-oh.
We're here at the zoo because we're getting some footage for the beginning of the movie, which is the zoo, supposed to be a depressed New York zoo. I have to say most of the animals in the zoo are not depressed. It's actually a really lovely zoo, and the animals seem pretty happy generally.
I'm talking real life adventure, the pursuit of the extraordinary. I'm telling you, boys, they're gonna have to dream up a whole new bunch of adjectives when I turn this picture in.
The other sequence we're trying to get shots for is when Denham is trying to impress investors with some safari footage that he's shot with him and Bruce Baxter, sort of posing in front of lions and tigers, trying to entice them with meat, but the lions and tigers actually are kind of looking bored and not really impressed. At least that's my understanding of what it's supposed to be. But we'll be filming the actors against a green screen, and we'll be shooting the lions and tigers separately, and then obviously they'll be put together in post-production. And hopefully we'll get some good footage.
Hi, I'm Suzette. I'm a team leader here at Wellington Zoo, and I've been coerced into looking after the film crew today, so just keeping an eye on things.
It was a thought.
Trying to get some animals to cooperate. If I bang a food bucket, they'll probably look this way and might give them their attention. Come on, guys! Oi!
Scientific approach.
Santa! Come on, guys! Well, you know. It's not as good as it gets.
Yeah, let's go.
They're in the game.
Okay, we're on the move.
Because of the candid nature of shooting animals...
We're going to go for lions.
It's actually a little bit difficult to set things up.
So problem with this mag?
Potentially, yeah.
We tend to just quickly rush and set the cameras up and shoot what we see happening at the time.
Do you see you shooting?
Well, monkeys for the zoo sequence is sort of really important because obviously there's a sort of a relevance to King Kong there. And we're going to go down to Monkey Island shortly and try and get some of the smaller monkeys that sort of leap around the place and swing from limb to limb. We'll also try and get some, I think there's some giraffes and zebras.
Peter's decided he wants to have spots on the zebras.
Which may be useful for the safari footage as well.
Seriously though, we're actually here shooting some plates for Carl Denham out on safari to match the background.
We've been trying to get some footage of animals behind bars, which we don't have too much of now, which is actually quite good for us, but not for you.
Because most zoos nowadays, they don't put them in these small enclosures with bars, whereas in the 1930s that was the norm. I think there's some intention that in post-production they'll put some bars across using CGI. We've even got a little set of bars which we've brought with us.
Listen to that, can't you hear it? Solid steel.
In the hope that we can possibly use that in some scenarios.
It's gone out of the sun. It's now officially a shade bear. Sun sensible bear.
Yeah. It's been a great day, actually. I just get to hang out and feed a few animals, and yeah, it's been good.
Welcome to shoot day 70. 6 more days till Christmas vacation.
Yes, yeah, 6 days till Christmas, and we're filming in the Civic Theatre. And we chose the Civic because it's New Zealand's grandest old picture palace, also a live theatre as well, and it just seemed that if we were trying to find an amazing theatre to represent New York in 1933, that this was really the place to do it.
So it's authentic to the time period. But yeah, we're not saying what Broadway theatre, because it wouldn't match any Broadway theatre if someone was a stickler for detail.
That's not the way the Ziegfeld looked.
You know, so we're avoiding that. But it's pretty impressive. The theatre's pretty badass, I like to say.
A lot of extras today, big work for all of the ADs and the wardrobe and makeup department, obviously, to get these people ready. They look absolutely wonderful.
Well, the clothes are utterly fabulous, as you can see, and the guys look absolutely elegant, don't they? So everyone's thoroughly enjoying it, the furs and the beautiful gowns and the hairstyles.
Nice to see you. Wave with the poor.
Well, these girls look hot in their little outfits.
It's King Kong, the 8th wonder of the world. Let's go to page 2. Page 2 is all about King Kong with Miss and Darrow, the 8th wonder of the world. Now, is the 8th wonder of the world Miss and Darrow or King Kong?
I'm from the Tribune, he's from the Times.
No one reads the Tribune, though.
How many extras I got today?
We got 230, but it feels like about 1,020.
Ooh.
Just listen up. Guys up the top, if you can watch what's going on, that would really help me out. What we'd like to do, you guys on the outside are going up the stairs, you guys are going straight through, you guys straight down the guts, and you guys around to the right-hand side, all right?
Excuse me. I know your film is very important.
You don't know what you're going to see, but you know it's going to be something amazing, as is exactly what it turns out to be. And that Denham down here is the guy that captured him. He's the centre of everyone's attention. So some of you can even...
This is the first shot of the day. A big, wide establisher. All the punters coming to see Kong, and boy, are they in for a surprise.
Start rolling. Okay, talking, folks. Let's hear it.
This is great. This is the only time where we can actually talk and not get told off. Perfect scene. We should have a scene like this all the time.
We can talk.
Hey! We can probably sing as well. Hey!
Yeah. We're making movies and we can make as much noise.
Well, you know, camera malfunction. What can I say?
Yeah, contrary to popular opinion, it was not me that shrieked out in terror.
All right. One of the
the part.
This is like the shooting of Jack Ruby or something. He's holding his heart.
It's like the shooting of Jack Ruby. It's right, it's the Jack Ruby moment. It's right in the basement.
We're getting through it, and it all looks very nice, and it's pretty much what I would imagine a big glitzy theatre night from 1933 to look like.
So we've just finished day 73 and the crew are moving back down to Wellington from Auckland. The Civic's all done now and we've got three more days of shooting before our Christmas break. And there's a good chance though on this travel day for me to catch up with the most popular question, I guess, or one of the most popular questions has been people asking for more information about conceptual art. So for Adrien, Alexandros, Chris, two Chrises, Danny, Dwayne, Jeannie, Jesse, Johnny, Miki, Sarah, and a lot of other people who've asked about the process of conceptualizing the film and then how that's taken through the production design, I thought we'd just, you know, look at a couple of examples. The thing with conceptual art that I enjoy mostly is the inspirational value. For instance, you know, we always knew that in our movie we wanted Kong to fight a T-Rex. So one of the very first things that I had our conceptual artists draw up for me were a whole series of pictures of Kong fighting a T-Rex. The one in Newsweek that we released is a good example of that. The design of Kong is not the final design of Kong. The T-Rex doesn't really look like the T-Rex that's in the movie because these are not creature design drawings. These are just inspirational mood and atmosphere.
How it works is Gus and I will get a very detailed brief from Peter as to what he would like to see sort of regarding the next set build. Gus and I can go away and do whatever we want, and that's generally called a first pass. And we'll come back with however many paintings and get a very clear, succinct critique from Peter. Sometimes we'll have the opportunity to do a second or third pass, depending on what we've missed or what he's seen and liked and possibly would like to change.
You sometimes get ideas for the choreography of the fight based on their drawings. I just love them to be doing stuff for me with no rules, with no instructions really, just come up with some cool images. And that's a really valuable way in which conceptual art can actually feed into the creative process. It's very inspirational. And then it obviously informs the designing of the film. I mean, for instance, you know, we have the scene in our movie from the 1933 film, The Log Chasm. And so we had to obviously look at the idea of what is the log chasm. I didn't want it to be fundamentally anything different than the original film, so it's a chasm with a fallen tree across it. But I wanted to make it a little bit fresh, so we explored the idea of just making the forest look different, and I thought these roots and the way the vines hang over the edge of the cliff was interesting. You're always just trying to look for things that you haven't seen before. I always thought that the tree, rather than being horizontal like it is in the original film, I thought it'd be fun if the tree was actually on an angle, so you had to go uphill to climb over the tree. And then on the other side of the chasm, I wanted to just get a sense, some vague trace of the ruins on Skull Island.
So I'm standing next to the design marquette for the log chasm. We've built a variety of scales trying to analyse what is required for the log chasm and the log across the gap. And we've worked up those scales, interacting with Peter and the art department as we've gone.
With the log chasm, as with all our big sets, the interpretation from there on is just about size. The concept art is sort of our Bible on each set. It's different, of course. But in terms of the build itself, the texture in the logs, the colour of the mosses on the logs, it's a great tool for anyone who's working on it, whether it's the sculptors or whether it's the painters or the dressers. Everyone has that as their sort of base reference. And in this case, we have the side of the chasm they approach from, Kong's side of the chasm, and the log that spans the chasm.
This is our version of the famous log scene, which was obviously used in the original film and in the 1976 remake, so how can we do without it? It's one of the iconic moments of Kong, and it's obviously a scene that most people will be expecting to see, and we don't want to disappoint them. So we've built this mechanical platform with basically a big rubber tree, and the idea is that we've programmed moves into the computer control platform that simulate roughly what Kong will be doing when he shakes and wobbles the tree.
And then there's one more step that follows the shooting on stage, and that's the building of the production miniature. Now, the marquettes that we use for the design are never actually filmed. And so what will happen with the log chasm now is that we've finished shooting the set, and now Richard will continue the process, and he will use what finally got built on set to form the basis of the miniature that he'll build, which is then based also on the earlier Marquette and the production design, conceptual art.
What we'll do now is turn this Marquette over to John Baster, who is our miniature supervisor, and he will utilise it to build the final landscape model.
And his production miniature, which is going to be huge, will incorporate the deep chasm, it'll incorporate the towering cliffs, the depth, it'll have everything that was impossible for us to build on stage. But it will match, ultimately, what did get built on stage, so we can blend the two together. It's a fairly straightforward pipeline that we developed over Lord of the Rings, and it's great for me because it allows me to feel the design coming together slowly and to have input at various stages and to really try to get the best of everybody's ideas to finally gel into what ends up on the film.
So it's day 76, which is significant for us because it's our last day before we break for Christmas. And it's, you know, we've had a fairly busy, intensive 14 weeks of shooting. I know I feel quite tired. I'm looking forward to the break.
Well, there have been so many great sets. My most favorite would probably be the diner, the New York diner, because it reminded me of home and it was just fabulous.
First night shoot, dump tanks. All that water crashing down on deck and Andy falling overboard.
Oh, yeah.
And no one yelling cut and all the boxes being thrown down and there was Andy hanging off the boat. Legend.
Yeah. Oh, man. What a night.
A nice memorable moment. Can't tell you that one. No, I can't tell you any of the memorable bits. Yeah, most of them happen at the weekend.
I can't tell you the most memorable off camera. That's a secret for me and me alone. I don't know, I like so many things.
I think my most memorable moment is freezing to death out there in the swamp with Colin Hanks and everyone else freezing with us. That was kind of memorable because it was freezing. It was cold for days. So yeah, that would be the one. Sure. And this, of course, is quite memorable.
I mean, my least favorite moment on the movie you shoot, you know, has definitely got to be today. In that water, man, freezing our asses off. I mean, we do have wetsuits on and stuff, but when you're not really moving around, you're not creating much insulation in your wetsuit. It gets pretty darn cold, and we were in there for a while, and the waves just coming in. I swallowed a bunch of water and stuff, and I almost vomited at one point. That wasn't a lot of fun.
To celebrate the end of this first block of shooting, we're having a Christmas competition for the crew, which is basically involves guessing how many setups we have shot since the shoot began.
A shot is a camera angle. If we have a setup and there's four cameras on it, that means there's four setups. Every time we move a camera, change a lens, do a different speed, officially that's a setup.
I've got absolutely no idea whatsoever. I'm a runner. I can tell you how many afternoon teas I did.
That shots? I know, bro.
All right, so if you remember, the contest was to guess how many setups all units have shot since the beginning of the shoot. Was it 14 weeks ago? Very interesting results. Very interesting results. First of all, we will announce the names of the people who were the wrongest. One of the wrongest people was Sarah Weinberg, who estimated that since we have begun shooting, we've shot two setups. I don't know what planet Sarah's been on. Please, you've been working too hard to notice we've actually been rolling film occasionally. The results, the numbers, the main unit in the 76 days, we've shot 1,126 setups. The second unit have shot 437, but then there's the miniature department. And the miniature department, since shooting began, has shot 3,300 setups. The winner of the competition, who wins the travel voucher, with a close guess, not correct, about 35 shots too low, with 4,872 shots, is Mike Minogue.
I guess I was wrong, though. I thought being a runner would hinder me, but obviously it helped a lot. The largest waterfall start with but a single drop.
So thank you so much for all of your hard work in the first 14 weeks of shooting, and obviously everything that goes before that, and have a great Christmas. You really deserve it. Thanks so much. Thank you.
Hello, loyal viewers of KongIsKing.net. We'll see you next year. Have a great holiday.
All right, Merry Christmas, and have a Happy New Year.
Right, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. And see you next year. And no, I lost the point! I lost that because I was talking to you because you're more important than well. Funnily enough, and I truly believe that.
Have a happy, safe holiday. See you next year.
Have a safe holidays. Season's greetings to you.
Bye.
Merry Christmas.
Just say to you all, have a fantastic Christmas. Enjoy yourselves. Be safe. Enjoy.
Well, Merry Christmas, everyone, and Happy New Year.
Have a very, very happy Christmas and an extremely merry new year. We've been working very, very hard. We're looking forward to this nice break. But have fun, be merry, be happy, be safe, and we'll see you next year. Bye.
Hi, everyone. This is Bob and Ned. And, of course, I'm Naomi, playing Anne Darrow. And I just wanted to say happy holidays. Have a great time and a happy new year to you. I'm going to be around a lot more next year, and the guys have been chasing me in the jungle, and I've been doing my Christmas shopping. But seriously, I'll be around, and I'll see you somewhere, maybe on the top of the Empire State Building.
He's going to say goodbye to everybody.
Yeah.
Going to wish them all a Merry Christmas.
And a Happy New Year.
And a Happy Hanukkah. And
all that.
Kwanzaa.
What else that's
is
right.
going on around this time of year?
I don't know. There's probably a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, whatever you feel like celebrating.
Celebrate it well.
Celebrate it hard.
Yeah,
because that's what
hard.
I'm going to do.
Yes, for sure.
And I don't care if you're naughty or nice.
Skull Island is done.
Skull Island's done.
Yeah, yeah. 2004 is done.
2004 is done.
Bring on 2005 is what I'm
we'll
saying.
We'll see you when we get back.
2005.
Later.
Bring it.
Bring it.
Okay, here we go. We're shooting now. Whatever you want to do, do it now. Yeah, do some movement. You look big. But don't move too much. Good.
There we go. We're done. Our Christmas break.
Thank you. Thank you both. That's a wrap. And Merry Christmas, well, happy holidays to you all.
Look forward to Christmas Day, or as we call it in the business, the old TA25.
Yeah. Yeah.
Happy New Year, everybody. This is not a production diary, but it's a warning that we start shooting again next Monday, so expect to see production diaries quite soon. Looking forward to getting back on set. We've been spending our break having a rest and Christmas, and then the last 2 weeks we've been in the cutting room, basically just editing as much as we can. You know, it's really helpful to obviously see cut footage before you've actually finished shooting. It helps sort of focus you and center you on where you are with the movie. So we've got quite a bit of cutting done over the last couple of weeks, and looking forward to getting back on set next week. We start shooting our New York scenes. You've seen the set being built and prepared.
We've got 5 days to go before shooting starts. We're very busy at the moment, but I'm sure we're going to make the deadline. As you can see, work is just powering on around here, and it's all good.
So, see you next week, everybody.
All righty, good luck, everybody. Here we go. I want to hear 3 loud camera sets, please. Shooting, thank you. And roll sound. And action!
So welcome to day 77. It's our first day back in the new year, and as we've been talking about, we're here on our New York street sets. I'm sure everyone's been going crazy the last few days getting it ready, the last few weeks in actual fact.
So this is the beginnings of us shooting the montage. Jabez and I cut a black and white sort of mock-up version of it, and this is the first day that we're just shooting bits and pieces that are going to cut into that modern version of that vintage montage.
Everybody, we're going to do it again. It was so good.
This is New York in 1930. Life has become very unbearable here. This is the time of the Great Depression. Everyone is hungry. There are fewer jobs to go by. We have been protesting. The government doesn't seem to be helping us. People are becoming very agitated, united, and with concerted action, I'm sure we'll get something. But at the moment, things don't look very good at the moment.
Move it along. Keep it going. Keep it moving. Come on, nothing to see. Nothing to see.
Now we're trying to keep it in order. You show them the nightstick, they generally behave themselves.
But we're mainly concentrating on setting up ambience and atmosphere of New York in 1933. You know, to be very real, nothing stylized about it. We just finished at about 10:30 last night, putting all the last final bits and pieces, final paint touches. We've still got a little bit of sign work going on and some dressing work, but, you know, we just made it. And here we are with a huge, great big crowd shots today. So we've been very careful with the selection of cars and particularly colours of cars. And there's been very careful selection of all the colours of the buildings as well to keep them kind of muted. The sort of textural quality is quite gritty and grubby, given that this is the midst of the Depression.
Well, this is a period that interests me a lot because I've been a history teacher all my life, and I've taught this period, the 1930s, the 1930s in America, and the Depression, what led up to it time and again, and there's a wonderful wealth of historical record, of photographic record from there, and see a lot of it just coming alive in the shop fronts and what's in the shops. And the apple cell around the corner there is an actual photograph that I'm sure that's modelled on. The orchardists up country in New England couldn't sell their apples, so they just got shipped down, blokes went up the trucks and brought them down again, and the unemployed sold them on the street corner, and we've got them right there. So it's an astonishing piece of work. It's a matter of walking through the past 75 years ago, and it's all alive around us.
Thanks, folks. That's a shooting wrap. Thank you very much, everybody. Fabulous day. Thank you, everybody out there in Radio Land. Fabulous day.
Can you hear me now? Okay, so now what we want to try and do, pick a direction and just walk in it and just keep going in like a big circle, like you're a bunch of ants going off to get some stuff. Does that make sense? Like you're a whole lot of ants just mizzling around. Alright?
People all the way down there, so you can actually turn around and walk back up the street again.
That's more like it.
Hi, welcome to day 82. We've got 400 extras on today. We're in New York streets. We've got a mix of about 200 men, 200 women, and quite a nice ethnic mix as well, so that we can try and be as authentic to 1930s New York as possible, even though we're in Wellington.
Most of these guys are going to be hired for the week, so we're hoping, we've actually put them into 3 costumes. We've triple fitted them, so we can use the same people as much as possible.
That's me.
That's you.
Dressed up to kill there with a fur coat. And now look at me, I'm like a pauper.
This one's an uptown hat. That one's a downtown hat.
It's been an exciting morning, yes. Got up at around 4:30
To make sure we got here on time, because our call was, what, six or something?
Mm.
Six, yes. And then once we got in the line, which was the very end, we tried on costumes, which I've never worn before. I don't know who I am, but I'm sure we'll discover that soon. And now I'm in the makeup line, which is about, it's like about an hour long. Down there, an hour long. It's going to be great. I love being an extra.
They gave us the best breakfast I've had in ages, treated us like kings. It's quite nice, pancakes, everything. Got quite full. And then just had to sign in, and now we better be quiet.
Now, the nice big wide roads, and there's going to be traffic on them. There's going to be over 70 pitcher vehicles. There's going to be a tram that's going backwards and forwards. So treat those roads as they were roads out in the middle of Wellington. So be very aware, and if you see anybody going too fast, that we do have a speed restriction, just give them the finger.
Ooh.
That's
even if he's bigger than you.
This finger. All right.
Good morning. Yeah, just head right round to the back. All the boys are going round over there because there's about five makeup artists that are only doing boys, and all the girls come through and go over to Tash and get a wig and a bit of paper with all their notes on it, and then she directs them to where they're going.
We're doing a 1930s uptown lady, so she's a little more made up and has her hair done. Downtown ladies have cloches and have their hair covered. So she's going to have a little lipstick and her eyebrows defined.
We're sort of casting as we go. We've got a basic list that I carry with me. It's like a Bible of everyone's name.
Michael Fowler, Michael Grubb, Michael Ross, Michael Wylam.
Trevor Cook. Not to be confused with Tracy Crook.
No,
check.
I know. Keeping very strict notes because we've already had to use so many different people who we weren't expecting. Finding people to help out in the soup line. This morning we redressed someone to be a Salvation Army person.
We were in the soup kitchen serving soup to a lot of the down and outs of New York. And 1933 was a period of depression, so there were a lot out there. And they were cold and hungry, and so the Salvation Army at the time must have spent a lot of time feeding people who had no work and no homes to go to.
Fight for work! Fight for work!
Tend to have more men usually on the streets of New York. It's just sort of quite appropriate for the time, the scenes we're shooting. We're doing unemployment queues and things like that today.
Oh, starving. Haven't eaten for 10 minutes.
We've got a few kids here, but not many, only about 10 of them. We've had a few of them up the front of the soup lines. With children, they don't have as long a time span on set, so we try and just use them for one or two scenes and then get them home again. They can't last as long as the adults for the sort of 12, 14-hour days.
What makes a good extra for us is someone with incredible patience and a good sense of humour, because they spend a lot of time sitting around waiting.
Well, we're doing one more shot. Actually, you never know when the last shot is going to be.
I can see us being here for another couple of hours, and you just do the same thing over and over again, and you can see why the movies do take a long time to make. I can see that.
I'll take you on now, and just we might have one more little practice. All right.
Day 85, hot cup of tea, 4:05 in the morning. It's a night shoot, and we're shooting in the New York streets. One of the great things about making a film in this period are the cars. I mean, it's a great age for vehicles, 1920s, 1930s. And I don't particularly know much about cars. I'm not a petrol head, as we call them down here, but we have some great people like Jeffrey, who has been organizing all the vehicles for us that we're using in the film.
We had to create taxis, military vehicles, police vehicles, and civilian vehicles, and it was easy to do that, really, because there's a lot of those cars around still. Amazingly, in New Zealand, there's still a lot of vintage cars.
25 of these vehicles are owned by owner-drivers who have donated their time to the love of their cars.
It's great, and they sit around chatting on their cars and when they're not working, and it looks just like 1930 in New York.
Some of these guys are like 70, 60 and 70, but they're here and they're dedicated and they want to see this movie, the authenticity, come out the way they can.
And this is my 1919 Hupmobile. It's really nice to be on the streets of New York with it, because it's exactly the kind of environment that a car like this would have been part of. It wouldn't have been new then, it would have been 14 years old in the time depicted by this movie, which means it would have been owned by somebody either poor or who had been wealthy, fallen on hard times. lost all his money in the crash.
It's quite amazing that these cars are 80 to 90 years old, and some of them were just absolutely nuts and bolts and nothing left, no running gear, and these team of mechanics have managed to rebuild these cars and make them go. They've converted them from right-hand drive to left-hand drive to keep authenticity of the movie and the time.
This is the steering arm that goes to the box, and this arm here is what just transmits it there. This arm here has to be taken and put on the other side.
This is going to be a parked car because it's too far gone to resurrect.
This is what was left of it when they pulled it out. And a day and a half later, it is on the trailer over there, ready to be used on site.
Yep, we've just had a fault on the generator. It's not driven off the fan belt, because in the early cars they didn't. They actually drove it off the timing chain that runs the valves in the motor. So we've whipped it out, done a temporary repair, just putting it back in. We're about to put the battery back on, crank it over, and see where that generates.
And if you want to get into it, I'll take you for a burn.
Imagine getting out of a horse and buggy into this is like getting into a spaceship.
1933, no road rules. None of the cars have got indicators on them.
Now, before the advent of electronic indicators, we had this hand-operated one. Right turn. Stop.
We're getting used to now driving on the right-hand side of the road, aren't we? Which is a bit awkward, because you have to think about going across to the opposite side of the road. When we leave here and go home, the hard part is now then to keep on our left-hand side of the road, isn't it?
That's me there. Model T behind.
I was behind Model T.
Was I
your
here
Model T coupe was there.
Yeah, right, it was up there.
I leave it to these guys.
There was nothing on that corner.
A lot of driving in circles and backwards and forwards and resetting, but we're getting the hang of it now.
Cab's on the move.
Best thing about this car, mate, came from New York in 1930, and now it's gone back to New York, 2005. It's amazing, eh? Time travel, thanks to Peter Jackson.
Welcome to day 87 of the shoot. In the final film, you may only see a small fraction of the detail that goes into the set dressing of New York. So this is an opportunity to have a look at the streets and shops of New York and see all the hard work and research and detail that's gone into recreating New York in 1933.
165 Bravo, take one, B marker.
It really came down to what parts of New York that we were trying to create here in terms of the story.
We can put a distant view of Broadway down one of our blue screen streets.
So we've sort of built a theatre district, which is at the lower end of the set. We're doing Times Square at one stage, we're doing Herald Square, which is where Macy's is. It's New York compressed into two blocks.
There's also a sort of a middle to lower class kind of part of town where it's perhaps more ethnically diverse, with a lot more colour and a lot more kind of life to it, I guess. So the part of town we're sort of standing in at the moment reflects that, you know, hardware shops and apothecaries, delicatessens and gun shops, which they used to have. So it's really sort of a potpourri of that sort of neighbourhood.
And you can see behind me, this is a theatrical supplies store. It's in the downmarket end of town, so we've had to sort of interpret whether or not it would be, you know, an upmarket, downmarket kind of a street, and what those differences would be. And we've taken pretty much a kind of gone a sort of cluttered way for the more downmarket places. Like, for instance, this one over here, the little Wali's, which is a Chinese bazaar, which is just absolutely full to the brim of stuff.
Well, one of the nice things about doing research is you often come across unexpected little details that you would never have thought of. I mean, we found this great sign for the NRA, which is the National Recovery Association. It was a government-sponsored way of generating work for unemployed people. And there's a lot of those sorts of signs, graphics and flags hanging around New York at the time, so we've also got a smattering of them on our set as well. Lutzenbergers. We thought we're going to need a sort of kosher butchers here, just because it's we found reference of the butchers.
So these were moulded off real carcasses, and it took like a week for the mould to set. So you can imagine how it was when he was unwrapping the mould.
Oh, we have maggots.
the sort of type of stuff that was used, you know, displaying chickens with their heads on, all that sort of slightly gruesome stuff was sort of everyday in back in the 30s. They didn't come in plastic bags, you know. So yeah, it was all part of the sort of major effort that's gone into this major dressing team.
We're standing in Times Square, and we've got a lot of trouble to copy a very good 1933 photograph. And in doing so, we've tried to use all the same shops and as much of the same dressing as we possibly can. For example, Worth and Worth is a hat shop that was on this particular corner in Times Square in 1933. Same with the Kaiser underwear shop. Next door to it again was actually the Dolly hat shop.
When you look at it from a distance, it looks like a normal shop. They look like, you know, the big blocks. The depth looks like it's there. You know, it looks like a functioning street. It's just when you get inside them, you see that, you know, we are cheating a little bit.
So we've done a lot of dressing around the windows and things like that to make it feel like it's got more depth than it actually has. And of course, we have to be prepared for Peter. You know, he may invent something on the day. So we've sort of gone a little bit further than perhaps we needed to with the dressing inside the doorways and further back behind the windows, just in case he does want to get closer to these shops. I'd like to think that we just give it greater depth, even though it's the background, and people will be able to look past the actors' heads and maybe see some details they like.
Why is New York steaming? I think it has something to do with thermodynamics.
What is under the streets of New York?
The steam is from Middle Earth. It's actually, they built this set on top of Lord of the Rings, and there's orcs and Uruk-hais down there.
Well, everybody knows why there's steam coming out of all these gutters and holes in New York. It's the breath of the alligators that live in the sewers, the huge alligators that are breeding underneath the streets of New York. And on cold nights, the condensation from their breath rises through the grills.
It looks like innocuous steam, but it actually smells.
It's the sewer. The heat, the steam, the fragrance that comes off one's poos is somewhat warmer than the outside temperature, thus creating condensation of steam that oozes out of the ground.
When I think of New York, I think of steam coming out of the sidewalk. The initial discussions with Peter and Grant were about capturing this grimy, sort of seriously depressed look.
It is a bit of a convention to have steam in New York. It's sort of like fog in London. And maybe it's a cliche, you know, maybe it's not like that all the time. But yeah, Peter did ask for it.
Is that smoke that you're comped in, that real smoke?
Yeah, that's steam.
Yeah, I mean, it works, to put that as, works much better than CG smoke, doesn't it?
How they generated the steam, I have absolutely no idea.
Boiled water, isn't it?
Low-lying clouds.
New York is probably full of hot air.
You know, we essentially came onto a site which was just like cleared land. There's a series of trenches dug all the way through the site, and then we're able to pour the concrete paving and prepare all the tarred sealed roads on top of that again. So it was built, you know, in some ways like a city. Perhaps the first foot or so, you know, did have quite a lot of plumbing in it.
It's been a big job to get the pipes in. They've been laid right from day one, the start of the building, as I said. We've had people down here putting in the pipe work. It's taken 3 months prep to get to this point where we've got it actually up and running and working now.
Anything that came out of the drains from the sewage system or just pipes running out was quite cool.
There's actually a whole lot of rodents that live in the underground. They're all smoking. That's what the steam's all about.
Oh, I think it's all the raunchy goings-on happening.
Yeah, bring it on, I say.
The only real way of getting steam, real steam, is just by boiling water. And so they bought all these boilers and put them behind the facet facades.
This here beside me is one of two boilers that we've got that are supplying the steam. We've hooked into a pipe system right throughout the set. Just approximately K and a half, maybe up to 2 kilometres of pipe throughout the whole set.
And this is one of our distribution manifolds. We've got 9 of these around the set. It's just supplying all the outlets with steam from manifolds.
There's 42 of these outlets, all different. Some of them are like manholes in the road. Some of them are sort of grates up on the footpath, and there's a huge grill, which I'm assuming represents like an underground of some sort.
Getting a steam bath. Some of the steam residue builds up water in the pipes, and then comes through and starts bubbling up through the grate down here.
Part of my job is to go around every sort of 20 or 30 minutes and empty some of these ones out.
Luckily it's wet here, so we can keep the roads wet with the hot water. It all looks good. Steaming puddles.
To try and recreate the 1930s feel of New York and make it as realistic as possible. You know, that's something that we've always found with Peter. You know, whether it's Lord of the Rings and now King Kong, you know, these are fantastic environments, but they always have to feel real.
Truth is stranger than fiction, you know, often when you go back and study the actual detail of these things, it makes them better than what it would be if you invented it out of your head. So the steam is sort of part of that. I know that it's unlikely steam would be an all-day, everyday event for New York, but for our movie, it sort of it suited it, and it's just one of the details that makes it come alive.
Hi, I'm Ernst Farrell. Join me in the night of the life of lighting continuity.
Jesus, Ernst, come on, man, you're late for work. For God's sakes, get out. We've just been looking for you. Come on.
Shit, not again. What are you doing? You're killing yourself, man.
Okay, not so loud.
At the beginning of this job, Andrew asked me to sort of put some sort of lighting continuity together for the film. So Ant's name came into the plot, as it were, and he'd worked on Lord of the Rings before. He knew basically what Andrew wanted.
Hi, Ant. Hi, Andrew. Listen, the DOP.
Hi, how's it going?
Good.
You're lucky it's only the hand this time. Lighting continuity is basically gathering information on lights. If it wasn't for lighting continuity, it would make it slightly more difficult for other departments, i.e. wetter, a second unit, miniatures, to match what we've shot on set.
So we put together a system whereby we could do photographs with a digital camera. We also needed to be able to download to a data bank at any time. So we needed to put some sort of system together that we could carry around on set with us as well, so we could just log in at any time. So we both sat down and devised a program, and basically Nance has sort of taken it under his wing and basically has expanded it a lot more than when we first started off.
I'm taking photos of lighting positions and camera positions and getting lens information from each of the cameras and what they will be marked as. Important for anyone that's trying to match up information with a particular camera shot. Obviously some setups are bigger than others, so some challenges are bigger than others. Hi, Helen. What lens have you got, and what will you be marking the camera as?
We've only got three on hotel, one on golf.
Same camera is on 65 mil.
What's it been slated as?
32.
65, sorry.
65, yeah.
Three camera.
Happiness?
Yeah, you would have to put the most confusing setup for me to be on film with.
So now having gathered all that information off the street, so to speak, I can now enter it into the continuity software here. We've been given the information of 65 mil, so we're going to slot in a 65 mil lens.
If
we've got a lot of lights working in one set, I've got to basically make sure I've documented them all.
Nobody laughing or smiling. Remember, this is just not fun. Thank you. And background! Go theatre people!
It's quite tricky to actually try and get camera positions and all the main players light-wise in the same shot, but sometimes I pull it off and it makes my job easy. I think at the last count I was up to about 1,800 photos. And on these photos, I've labelled the pods. They've all got reference numbers. You can relate that back to the plan. For instance, that's pod 3 on the plan. And that's pod 3 on the photo. 5-3, last setup, wrapping at 6 on paper, so this will be the last setup. This is our last move for the night.
Train's coming! Stuck on the train.
See how the crew digs in and helps in times of trouble?
There's a really big deal about
not like that much, exactly. Are they all late for work or something, or what?
Ah!
the dad.
It's been a bit of an emotional roller coaster, but hey, it's called filmmaking. If it was easy, everyone would be doing it.
Billy?
Billy, are you okay?
Tim? Quit fooling around, you guys, and put the lights back on.
And here we go, folks, and roll camera.
Here we are at the end of the week in Times Square. Over the weekend, it's going to be turned into Herald Square. So Monday night when we rock up into work, it'll be a different part of New York, 1933.
We've got teams of people working for the next 48 hours, day and night, moving the big pieces.
We've got a huge crew. We're all working right through the weekend, Saturday and Sunday. I think there's 2 hours in that period where we won't be working, and they'll probably come and ask us to work overtime on that.
We'll be running 40 men during the day, 20 men at night, which will include painters, carvers, because a lot of the facades, when they come off, will have to be cleaned up a bit.
And of course there's quite a big set change to be done between Times Square and Herald Square, but they both share the same road, Broadway, and so the configuration of the set didn't change per se. It's just we did building changes and signage changes and dressing in the middle of the square changes.
We've got the Horn and Harder building facade coming off to expose Macy's in behind it. Lots of canopies, the Gaiety, the Newsreel, the Mayfair, all canopies that are coming off, and different awnings going in their place, signage and so forth. Directly behind me here we've got the underground subway, which will be covered over by the Herald Square Monument.
I'll take my tree for a walk.
We had to know exactly what we were doing before we started. And we've had a model that we've had floating around for probably, must be getting close to a year.
You know, if you're sort of looking more like a reverse away from the theatre, all down there is quite a nice reflection, really, down there, whichever side of the line we ended up on.
We've done a lot of work in the set designs for these so that we were able to change them from one sort of building to another sort of building in a very short time span, mainly by putting one set directly in front of another. We also did quite a lot of taking away of the canopies that are more typical of Times Square and making it into more of a Herald Square sort of shopping area. I mean, that's where a lot of the big department stores are.
What's wonderful about this set is the attention to detail, and there's something about this that does exist in certain areas. There are, you know, old parts of Queens and Brooklyn with the elevated subway tracks, which I grew up, you know, a few blocks from, that this is very reminiscent of. We still have the same structure in my neighborhood.
And at Herald Square, there, in theory, is a railway station there. So we've built a big staircase. There's no actual railway station, but we've built the staircase.
Right, stairway to heaven.
Film. We've been sailing very close to the wind all the way through the film. And this was another one of those instances where we had to be very much on our toes to be able to pull it off.
I'm absolutely thrilled to get here. It was touch and go for a while there because we've had a few weather hold-ups in the last 3 days. But as usual, our fabulous construction, dressing, and set finishing teams—they've made it.
The reason we're in this tent is because it's raining cats and dogs outside. We have a taxi cut in half. We have Jack Black and Colin Hanks performing scene 17.
Step on it!
Okay, cut it.
We really didn't know if it was going to be a wet weather call until the afternoon, so we were powering through this, you know, assuming it's all going to be done on Monday, because it had to be done on Monday. We didn't know, if it was going to rain or not. And we had also prepared a wet weather cover set just in case it wasn't, and in the end they didn't shoot the wet weather cover set or Herald Square. They ended up shooting something else completely, but you know, we just have to be prepared for things like that because that's the business we're in.
So it's always difficult in movies when you have actors driving cars, and there's a number of ways that you can cheat that. One of the most common ways is obviously you sit in a studio in a car, but you have a blue screen behind them and they're stationary, and there's a couple of people rocking the car, giving it some movement, and they're talking, and eventually you put a moving background in behind. But there's a particular sequence in New York where Jack Driscoll, Adrian's character, has to drive somewhere very quickly. And Adrien, as it transpires, is a very good driver.
Very good. That looked like too much fun.
That one just ran out.
What's interesting is tonight, art is imitating life, because here I am in New York doing this car scene where I'm driving like a madman, and I grew up in New York driving like a madman preparing for this day. So it's really exciting.
We had no idea that Adrien was going to want to do his own driving. In fact, we hadn't really even planned for it.
Originally, we were going to do it all with stuntmen, and when I first arrived on the set, I heard that Adrien was quite a good car driver. So I took him out and checked him out, and it was true. He was an excellent driver. So instead of using the stunties, we used Adrien to do most all the close-up shots.
He's doing his own stunts now, so I'm unemployed.
It was partly Adrien's idea. He says, listen, you know, as long as the car's safe, why don't you just give me a go at driving it and just stick cameras on the car? And so what we did is we harnessed Adrien into the car very safely. We had roll bars built into the car so that if he should roll or anything happened to him, he would be safe inside the cage. And we put four cameras actually physically strapped onto the car.
Pete's got the say here, so I'm honored that he trusts me with hundreds of thousands of dollars of cameras on the car as I weave in and out of these streets.
There he goes. Oh, I might take a camera off the side of the car yet.
Adrien drove really well through the streets, slid the car sideways, reverse spins, 180s. Did a really good job.
And we just had Adrien driving as fast as he wanted to around our King Kong set. I mean, he just drove and took corners and went up alleyways, and he did it a number of times. We changed the camera angles. At some point he whacks into something and half the roof comes off.
I'll tell you one thing, the taxis have improved since Giuliani was in office.
We were able to achieve a lot of the sequence a way that's not normally done in films, which is the actor actually physically doing real driving. Normally, it's the last thing that happens. Normally, you fake it somehow. But this is a case of the actor driving for real and driving reasonably quickly, I have to say. Adrien got up to some fairly healthy speeds at certain times.
If you're capable of doing it, it's more believable. The way the lights reflect against the windshield and the G-force of me sliding across the seats. And you can't really replicate that as much unless the car is on some moving rig.
Basically, what we got is a fantastic sequence with our actor doing 99% of it, and that was a fantastic stunt. So, thank you, Adrien.
This is probably one of the most exciting days for me thus far.
So, today it's day 100. After 100 days of shooting, it all tends to be a little bit of a blur. I'm very tired. It feels like 100 days of shooting. A lot of people have asked if they could see what a typical day in the life of me is like. It's kind of typical. I mean, every day is different. For instance, it's 8:42 in the morning, and we don't start shooting till 1 o'clock in the afternoon, because at the moment we're on half day, half nights. But I'm rushing to editorial right now to sit down with Jamie, our editor, to actually cut the animatic I'm going to be shooting tonight.
Peter's schedule is a mighty beast of a thing, and we schedule as best we can, and things tend to get pushed, but we do get them done.
So I'm late. I would have been on time, but these video guys was here, and they were totally disrupted me.
What's the plan?
The plan is to get a look at the previs for the scene with Anne and Kong. This is a scene where Kong, instead of killing Anne, he has a curiosity about her, and she senses that that curiosity is the one thing that may keep her alive.
So we've got till 10:30 to cut this.
Plenty of time.
Yeah. So it's 10:41 now, and we didn't get our previs cut. Next week, Universal are flying 200 exhibitors and distributors down to New Zealand, and we're going to present them with the first footage of King Kong. Some visual effects shots are finished.
A lot of them are unfinished, so I'm going to shoot a little introduction to try to explain to people that are going to see this reel that, you know, they're going to be looking at unfinished shots.
Stand by. And camera set.
It's very important to me, obviously, as a director, that you understand that King Kong, we are still filming it. The film's coming out in December, and believe me, there's a huge amount of work still to be done. But nonetheless, we're hoping that this reel is going to give you a flavour and the tone of the film that we're making.
Great.
OK. I think that was all right.
Yeah, perfect.
I'm just going to go to Q stage, talk to second unit, make sure that they know what they're doing today in a vaudeville routine. The real day begins right now. OK, so what can we do to help you guys?
Well, actually, I just wanted to go over.
Well, the basic thing is to just capture the essence of the routine, shoot it very simply. There's nothing fancy about the camera work. Shoot two cameras so you can get a wide and a tight.
OK, good.
All right, guys, you guys, just call me if you have any problems or any concerns or questions at all.
Thanks, babe.
All right, so about to shoot our first shot of the day. It's 2 o'clock, an hour after we started today. So the first thing that we're doing is a shot of Naomi's stunt double, Min, being thrown onto the ground. All right, we shoot our first shot, slate. Boom, we're on our way.
And action!
And cut.
That's it.
That quick. But I think we should move on. I mean, is Naomi ready to go?
She just hasn't got her wig on. I have to put her wig on, but apart from that, she's ready.
So remember, this begins after you run, and you run over his leg, over his foot, and trip over, and then he confronts you, and that's as far as I got. And I think we're ready to shoot.
We're micing Pete so that he can be broadcast onto set.
Well, I've got so many mics today, yeah. I don't know what to do. I just have to remember to turn them all off when I go to the toilet.
Thank you. Here we go. Please shooting and roll
sound.
Guns rolling.
Back and action.
Throws her down. She lands. He's suspicious. She looks dead. And he prods. Another prod. He's not sure. He sniffs. Sniffing. One last big prod. And cut. OK, good. That was good. Let's just try one more for luck.
That's good. We'll do another, please.
Good. Should we try one more for luck? And that was good, Naomi. Yep. We'll just try one more for luck. Once more, please. Once more, just for luck. This is Victoria. You've met Victoria before. She's our script supervisor.
Hi.
And she had a whole video diary about you, and you haven't had one piece of fan mail yet.
I'll
write to you now.
Where are the girls of the world that would have just, like, gone crazy for you, Annie?
Even if it was one guy, at least there'd be something.
Oh, I see. OK. The boxing ladies. OK. The boxing ladies are going for it.
Ooh, it's a knockout.
One of them got one clean in the jaw, did they?
Yeah.
I mean, just get them to beat the hell out of each other. But give it more muscle. Just like, we want bleeding noses. It's 6:10. I've been going since 8:30, feeling a little bit tired, but have to keep on going till midnight.
What I have to do is find time to run back into the cutting room and finish cutting the animatic that I never finished.
Okay, gang, previs time. Let's try and trim up the first few shots in this sequence.
No time for pleasure whatsoever.
We should give that rotation to them so they know that's what's sort of about to happen. What do you reckon, Pete?
So it's this shot here. You're on the ground, you back away, and then you accidentally just stumble. And that doesn't have to be a big fall backwards. That could just be a stumble and a kind of a half fall.
Right.
Because it's just enough to engage him.
Here we go, please. Shooting fashion. And play that. And action.
You're terrified, you're gonna die. His rage is building. He's gonna kill you. He's getting angrier. He's gonna kill you. Here he comes, and
cut.
Yep, that's good. I thought that was fine.
People are always trying to get to Peter. There are always people sort of waiting in the wings to get answers, and quite often I'm the sounding board and go back and forth between those people.
It's my job, I'm the go-between.
This one, we're doing a couple of little tweaks again. This is more for a temp. You've seen a couple like this before, but this is just the next one in the series. This one, there's a long head handle on.
Sorry to interrupt, but second unit need to play down a couple of shots for you.
Okay.
We've got a full shot and then we've got a close-up.
It all seems very red. I think it would actually look better if it was against black.
Well, that's good. Let's do that.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Is that cool?
Sure. Thanks.
All right, no worries.
Thank you. Could you please ask Peter to come and join us now?
Thanks, Carol. I'll just get him for you.
Head handle on. And then,
Peter, this... they're ready for you on our stage.
Okay, there's got three more shots to go.
Carol, Pete's got three more shots to look at on the laptop and he'll be with you. It'll be pretty quick.
And we should get Andy's sound thing on.
One of the jobs that a director has to do is to answer questions all the time, and you have different departments coming at you constantly wanting meetings and information about this, that and the other. I found exactly the same thing on Lord of the Rings. At the end of Lord of the Rings, I was so tired I could only concentrate on one thing at a time. And, you know, it's getting a little bit like that on this film. Not so bad, but it certainly gets pretty exhausting.
Checking and wrapping, thank you.
Pass my stuff, please.
Good, well, there we go, the end of day 100.
Congratulations.
Yes, here we go. It feels like 100 days, too. Doesn't feel like 99 days, doesn't feel like 98 days, it feels like 100 days.
And it's a second unit's 50th day tomorrow, so I've put a note on their call.
50th day, oh, well, they've got
their only, on their call sheets.
They're only half the men that we are, Carol.
Happy
50th day. Thank you, everybody. I hope you've enjoyed this look at what a day 100 like it is for me. I'm going to go get some sleep and take my microphone off and say goodbye to you all and see you at the next video diary. Here's all your gear. Thank you.
Well, big day for us. It's day 200 on the miniature shooting schedule, which is day about 100 and a bit on the live action. We're a little ahead of them because we've had to shoot a lot of material before the live action started. So we're getting ready to shoot what is the actual first production film rolled on King Kong. Peter pointed this out yesterday, actually, that we were highly honored that we actually get to do this. Peter's a real hands-on filmmaker, always has been. I think he just loves the fact that there's a process involved in filmmaking, and part of that process is shooting miniatures that somehow enhance and extend a live-action set. So you have a small built set that's full-size, so they actually interact with the bushes and the trees and the vines, and then we're doing everything outside this. In effect, we're creating the entire environment within which these actors perform. So it'll be a combination of matte paintings and miniatures to bring it to life.
The main miniatures are made by Weta Workshop. We then have to transport them over here from Weta Workshop. Obviously, they're huge, as you've seen. And a phrase that got coined on Lord of the Rings was bigitches. That doesn't seem to have changed. There's still bigitches. And no, they're not little. They have to be huge because they're meant to be enormous.
Park it over the yellow line towards the wall.
We've got a few sets running at the moment. Normally have two or three, but presently we have five.
It's actually more than five because this stage is doing two shots, so we've got six setups.
I'm doing the boat next door in here, a rock wall here, sea wall here.
I think we either need to get roller skates or scooters or skateboards because we're really just racing back and forth.
With Motion Cost HK, we're shooting a gourd shot here that has to be out by pretty much today. We shot it yesterday, but it's a reshoot, so we're picking up shots 37 and 40.
We're in this set for a long time, a couple of hundred shots. And of course, it's built in tenth scale, so it's one tenth of full size. But at that scale, it means the camera's very, very close to everything. So we have to do a lot of precision detailing on plants, on the moving trees in the wind, on the way the rocks look, the way things have fallen down, and so forth.
The green spawn have done an amazing job of making these like little miniature ferns.
We've had these things for a year and 2 months. We started in December last year, and they would have been twice that size now if we didn't cram the poor little bastards into a small pot.
They can be on set for anywhere between 1 day and 2 months, and my job is to try and keep them alive in these extreme conditions, intense light, intense heat, and intense wind.
The trick is that because we have wind in these shots, the trees are blowing around in the wind, we got it, but they're miniature trees, we have to run the camera fast so that we can make slow them down enough so that they don't just go bzz, 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 bzz like that.
And to help with that, I'm putting little lead weights on them, which are little fishing sinkers, which we're clamping onto the leaves to give them a bit more weight so they actually move and look believable when we shoot them at 64 frames a second. Whatever's not behaving properly gets the lead shot treatment. So we'll put more wind on it, but now it's got more weight to it.
Because you have to use this for so many shots, it pays to get a very high level of detail, so no matter where you look, you've got the coverage. Live action units will be wrapping here in a month and a half, and we're going to be shooting until October of this year, way down at the very end, because we have this enormous number of shots. We got around, let's say, around 1,400 shots to do still before we finish. I figure that in King Kong, we probably got twice as many shots as we had in all three Lord of the Rings films put together.
I think one of the really special things about Peter Jackson as a director is his use of miniatures. And we're all very thankful that he uses so many miniatures.
And I think he's absolutely right when he says also that there's something about the photographed image, be it a live action plate or a location plate or a miniature plate, that somehow plucks a responsive chord in our hearts. And we say, yeah, I believe that.
Sea marker.
It's a scary day when you come to set and you have grown men attacking you in bright green and blue suits.
Hello, here we are. It's day 105. I've had some decent sleep since my day 100 diary, where I was so exhausted I could barely stand up, but I'm feeling much better now, and it's good because we're doing some pretty complicated stuff at the moment. It's in an area of the film that in a way demands the most imagination, because we have no sets. It's a sequence in which Naomi is being carried by Kong in New York.
And of course the way we'll do that, opposed to the old claymation version, is to shoot it all in front of a green screen here. A lot of the rest will be built in a computer at a later date.
We have something that looks like a green tire, I guess you could call it, and we have a rocking base. And although looking at the shots and looking at the way we're going to shoot it, it seems a pretty crude method, it's actually going to be fine. It's going to give us everything that we need.
The Kong rig is a pretty amazing and important part of the film. It's the iconic image that we're about to see of Anne and Kong's connection. This is where the action really starts. This is where the fun starts.
Keep it kind of, don't be too shy. And we have Andy Serkis on set to play Kong and to work with Naomi.
Naomi's stuck with looking at someone dressed like...
Yeah. I'll tell you, a ballet dancer on steroids.
But it seems to do the trick, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. But thank God for this. That's what I focus on.
Yeah.
I feel like completely transported when I look at his face. I'm not looking at him wearing a funny suit. I'm looking at him with all this behavior and all this feeling, and I can't imagine who else could make me feel what he's making me feel. It's really something.
Just because we can't touch each other doesn't mean that we can't really, get inside each other's heads, which is why I'm here.
And I saw you laughing at him, which was fun. Yeah. Playing with the lights was really good. I mean, that was great. That was really great.
So everybody knows when we hit Central Park, which is a lighting cue and a cue for Naomi as well.
There's slow, passive scenes with her and Kong having quiet moments together, and then there's obviously much more action-orientated scenes as Kong is being pursued by New York by the military. And sometimes he's running, sometimes he's protecting you, like he's running and protecting you here.
Sometimes
he's stopping and looking over here.
She's weird.
Yeah, she's much better at really performing than me.
You don't really need to train.
Right. It was good, that was nice stuff. And should we just try one more for luck, eh?
Okay.
Lift from the explosion. Screaming, yet a little stop.
No!
Searchlight sweep past. No searchlight sweeping past.
If you'd said at the beginning of the day, okay, so what you're going to do, Naomi's going to be in this green hand, you're going to be on top of a scissor lift, and you're pretending to be galloping through the streets of New York being chased by the military, you'd think, okay, all right. But I can't wait to see all the other elements put in. And I mean, for me, having lived through that scene now, be able to take it to the next level in motion capture, and given that I won't have Naomi there probably, but it'll be Barbie, you know, that'll be great.
Thank you very much. It was good.
That's kind of fun.
A whole day riding the hand.
Yeah, many variations.
Yeah, that's right. How many people out there would have liked a day in Kong's hand?
And we'll be going to the fairground.
It is.
That's got to be one of my most challenging days on a film set, I have to say.
Hi there, it's day 108 today, and we're doing a few more scenes on the deck of the Venture, which you can see behind me here in Studio B. But what we are actually going to do today is a production diary that's based on a lot of requests that we've had from fans. So for Lindsay, Roy, Jeremy, David, Anthony, Andrew, Kathy, Chris, Roxy, Josh, Hillary, and Brewer, we're going to do a day in the life of the makeup department.
Today I have the Manitou. And the Manitou is when it's a pimple that's so big that it's not just a pimple. There could be a living organism inside growing in a fetus inside my face.
So we might need to operate.
And then after 9 months, it pops and the devil comes out. It's the devil's child, the Manitou.
Hair and makeup are there for the director. They're there to realize his vision. And we're there to help the actors and actresses portray the parts they're playing.
One of the good things about being in hair and makeup is the fact that you get a big trailer like this.
The makeup trailer can be a fun place.
Oh yeah, everything happens in the makeup bus. All roads lead back to the makeup bus.
We are the first people that get the actors in the morning. And you know, not everybody gets a great night's sleep.
I didn't shave because today I have to have 2 days' growth. So I'm not unprofessional, if that's what you're thinking. Dude doesn't even shave.
A lot of my job is research, to search for information about a period. And there's no point putting lipstick and eyelashes on if you don't know why you're doing it.
I've had the same crappy haircut since August.
And he means that in the best possible way.
And I'm not saying that you gave me a bad haircut. She gave me a great haircut.
It's 1933.
Exactly, it's 1933. I think I had the same haircut when I was like 7.
As far as King Kong goes, we want to sell everything as if it actually happened. The thing we're aiming for all the time is realism. We also keep extensive continuity records, which means that we'll take photographs and take notes so that when we do have to reproduce it, we can do it quite efficiently and very precisely.
It's been a while. And we need to shape him.
Why not?
Andy Serkis shot scenes today that we initially shot before Christmas. So there was a little bit of continuity bringing him back to Lumpy, and we had to re-tattoo him and lots of dirt and grime and all those kind of things.
So now you'd have your food cooked by this man, wouldn't you?
Sometimes people are, the wounds are healing because it's a couple of weeks after, then reducing the wound or so forth, or the wound then disappears, all that sort of stuff.
It's great putting people through torture and pain and making them look silly and so on and so forth. Yeah, it's great.
I use hair and makeup as tools. You know, you arrive at work and in your normal fashion, and then you get into character, and you use makeup and hair to help you get closer to that.
Jack did a very smart thing and went wig so that he could have his normal Jack hair.
It wasn't really a move on my part to get a wig, but it worked out to my advantage because you throw on the wig and it gives me a 1930s hairdo, and then you take it off and look what's under it. Rock and roll.
Yeah, the wigs, I mean, my company makes the wigs because we weren't satisfied with the wigs that were around, and trying always to achieve them so that people don't know that they're actually wearing wigs.
Half the day, at least half the day, maybe more, is keeping the artist looking exactly the same. Let's say we start at 5 a.m. and we might shoot that one scene for 14 hours. So we have to keep everybody looking exactly the same for 14 hours.
What's happened by the time she's sitting in this chair until the time she's on the set, a lot of things can change. And so I always have to go up and check and make sure everything is just perfect.
Final checks.
Okay, jumping out of there, please, gang. I need to get Naomi in there. We're going to shoot.
It's all about people's personalities as much as the makeup skills and everything, that everyone gets on well and works well together.
And what they do to me.
It's such a glamorous business, isn't it?
You have to have very good chemistry with the people that are doing your hair and makeup because they're the last people to touch you before you roll. And I don't think it would be possible to do it without feeling those good vibes.
Okay, here we come.
Naomi's on set, we need you.
Gotta go.
Stop
Bye.
Your talking, come on.
Hello, it's day 110 here on the shoot, and what our production diary is going to be about is the recent summit, which was a visit that was arranged by Universal Studios, who brought a whole lot of people down to New Zealand to have a look at some footage. The summit is different to the press junket, which we showed you earlier. There were cinema owners, exhibitors, people that own distribution chains. There were people associated with the merchandising deals. And it was basically Universal's attempt to give them a very early sneak peek at what we were doing. And from our point of view, an early sneak peek is fine, but obviously it led to a huge amount of hard work, because in order to get a piece of film ready to show while we're still actually making it is obviously a big ask. And it wasn't like a trailer, 2 or 3 minutes, it was 18 minutes of footage that we wanted to screen for these people. So we went into overdrive to try to, at the very last minute, pull this reel together.
I think although people were as positive as they could be about the idea of the summit, the implications on their schedule were pretty difficult.
So the guys have been going great guns on building this fairly sizable chunk of miniature, and we have a very short deadline to get it delivered. It's almost an urban myth that things turn up on the back of an envelope or a napkin, but we actually got handed this design this morning.
It's definitely impacted us in animation. Put it this way, I don't think they were quite prepared to get stuff on film this early. We've got quite a few effect shots to do, which is somewhat daunting, and we try not to think about it too much, but we'll just keep slamming through it and get there.
What I'd do is I'd grade up scenes that we knew that were going to be in the summit reel. We didn't necessarily know every single shot, so I just had to grade all the shots in all of these scenes and send them over to editorial, and editorial had to put it in the cut.
It really put the pressure on the whole editorial department. And so it was one of those things that was right to the wire before we could actually get it ready to screen.
This will be the first time that an audience will see our work. So it's exciting for us, and we're really hoping that they enjoy it. I think everyone was really excited to be in New Zealand. Some of them were a little bit tired, but the first day they spent, they were so excited about what they'd toured around and what they'd seen. First up, we went for a visit out to Seaview, where the New York set is, and had their photos taken. Look at that.
New York in 1933, in living color this time, not in black and white.
They also got to have their photo taken outside the real venture.
Action!
It's very important that we get them very excited about what we're trying to do. So to that end, we've been taking tours of 35 people at a time, and we're walking them through the workshop and showing them everything that we've been doing. They've also been visiting the miniatures stage, the shooting stages, and other bits and pieces that's going on around Miramar. Well, I'll see you all in the cinema for more waffling in a minute.
And last but not least, they watch the Weta Digital presentation given by Joe Lettieri.
This is from the first week's shooting. This is the scene of Anne arriving at the docks. This is now putting all the bits together.
Later on in the evening, they returned back to the Camperdown Theatre for a surprise.
Dad, I just want to thank you again very much for coming down. I thought we'd show you a little bit of the film, but in a very crude, animatic way.
It's very unusual to be screening footage to anybody at this early stage, and I must admit I was a little nervous, and finally thought, oh my God, I'm actually going to be showing some people some of this film.
It was quite exhilarating for us, because Peter got a standing ovation, and so it seemed like it was all worthwhile, so it was really great.
Thank you all so much for coming
down. Thank you.
What was amazing about the summit reel was the reaction we got from everyone. It was just one of those things that gave the tone and the feel of the movie, and no one really had any idea what they were going to see.
It's great to finally, after a few months of seeing maquettes of Kong, actually seeing him move.
That was a really wonderful snapshot to get a sense of what the whole tone of the movie is going to be.
Keep up the good work.
The great thing about getting a good reception is that it gives you a bit of a morale boost, and it's made us sort of a little bit more excited about the film that we're working on. So looking forward now to just, you know, getting the shoot finished and push the film through to its completely finished date, so that this 18 minutes now becomes a fully fledged feature film.
Hi, welcome to the second unit production diary. I'm Randy Cook, second unit director, and we're going to show you today a few of the things that second unit's been up to for the last couple of months while Peter's been directing main unit.
Go ahead, pitch!
lot of the stuff we do tends to fill out sequences that have already been shot by main unit.
They basically film a scene and then we come along afterwards and pick up all the little bits that are left over.
So, as a result, I'm doing things that Pete has neither time nor inclination to do. Some of the shots out on the venture.
The only stuff we filmed on the boat so far has been in the parking lot. They say it's because it's a better controlled environment, you can get better shots, but we all know Peter's, I think he vomits, apparently. As soon as he steps on a boat, vomit happens.
And we got to shoot scenic shots of Anne and Jack being swept down a river.
What we're gonna do is have a bit of a Tarzan swing into the river. 3, 2, 1, swing into frame and let go at the right time. And hopefully we'll have a nice spectacular splash.
They're getting slapped around a little bit, so they're really suffering for their art today, that's for sure.
We've shot everything from typical inserts stuff to car chases, which is the usual domain of the second unit, to actual close-ups on the principal actors.
It's always a breath of fresh air, actually, going over to another unit.
Ready? And 3, 2, 1, head! 3, 2, 1, pat!
The treadmill was just, something that everybody got subjected to at one point or another.
3, 2,
pat! It was always a bit of a competition between everybody who could run the fastest on the treadmill. I was the fastest runner on the treadmill, but I almost needed hospitalization afterwards. Okay.
Peter and I have similar tastes in some areas. However, we only get to work together real briefly in the morning. He gives us a real quick brief about what he wants, and then we go out and do it and show him what we're up to.
We use video cables, we use internet. Wherever Peter is, he's going to be getting a picture from second unit.
This is our second unit monitor down here, which is showing us what second unit are doing. They're doing their vaudeville routines.
That's good.
It's a very interesting job being another director's hands, because you have to have the ability to do it, yet you have to go with that director's flow.
Yeah, we're on the Hooverville set today. Hooverville being sort of, I guess, the slums. It's the depression times. All the people are out of work, they're bored. They're just sitting around. We're just shooting a montage of shots. Basically, what we're filming here, the extras out there don't even know when the cameras are rolling.
I was a Hoovervillian today, and I sat around and acted bored, which I was.
Half the time, when you turn the camera off, they start looking natural. And as soon as you tell them they're turning it on, they look really unnatural. So we spent the whole morning rolling without anyone really knowing.
We were bouncing around all over the film on that day because we went from the shanty town to Skull Island with natives' feet running around in the rain to the skyscrapers of New York under construction. All of it, of course, was on the back lot, crammed quite close together.
From the depths to the heights today in more ways than one.
One of the exciting things about working on second unit for Peter is that you do get to do things that other second unit directors don't necessarily get to do. We're not, just expressly doing car chases and people falling in the river. We're getting to work with the main actors and sometimes getting to finish off scenes that he's started. Again, he gives you a lot of leeway at times. And one appreciates that trust.
I think you should be as extreme as you want to be. No, it's vaudeville. Go for it.
Boy, is that the right answer.
Go for it.
Hello, welcome to day 115. Today we're going to show you a little bit of the sound department. Several of you have written in wanting to know more about the technicalities of recording sound on set. Jeremy, Matthew, Jody, Don, Stefan, Akash, Ryan, Nick, Nathan, Keith and Mike. It's ironic that this particular production diary is on this day. Today happens to be the day that we're recording a scene involving our Carl Denham sound recordist. Because, of course, in 1933, they were having to record sound themselves, and they have much the same problems as we still do today.
We're off on a magical journey. A journey into sound.
My title is production sound mixer, and my job is to record sound at the time the film's shot. So, like the scene that we're doing today, we've got a whole heap of characters who are all going to be doing lines. which means I've got to put out a number of microphones, and I'll mix all that chat together to record the actor's dialogue. We're doing a master, and there's a lot of characters talking, so we need to put out a lot of mics. There'll be boom mics, there'll be plant mics or radio mics on people.
You think this is about sound? It's actually not. You're doing me for drugs.
That's right.
If you find any, you owe me money.
It's pretty amazing how these guys are able to hide microphones in ties and in jackets. The only downside to the radio mic is you need a little battery pack. Sometimes it's wrapped around your ankle like a prisoner on house arrest.
This is worse than house arrest, because now there's someone in your house listening to your every move.
You'll never notice.
Day in the life of a sound man. It's tough. It's tough what they have to endure.
We're going to be shooting very soon, thank you, gang.
Getting almost nervous now. It's the first shot of the day, and it's pretty tight in here.
Here we go, shooting, please.
And here we go.
And roll sound.
Sounds rolling. Speed.
And action.
I'm going to have the ship's engines over all the dialogue. Seagulls, camera noise, wind, God knows what else.
I don't care, Mike. You're the sound operator. Make it work.
Shot.
That was a bit of a roughie to start with, but we'll sharpen it up as we go.
Here we go, thank you. And roll sound.
Rolling.
Speak. I try and get everything I can on the boom. You know, you try and get a boom in there as much as possible because it's generally a better sounding microphone. So we're two takes into it now. We've found some problems. We've got a construction site next door. The supermarket's building a new car park or something. So it's very apt that we've got a scene about a sound recorder who's complaining about all this noise in the background, and we've actually got loads of noise in the background here.
Here we go, thank you. And roll sound.
Speed.
Why are you always saying speed?
Well, actually, Julia, that's a good question. Why am I always saying speed on set?
Speed? Well, that's a good question. It starts back a long time back. Me and my friends were back in the pub in about 1962. And then my friend...
Also part of the sound department's job is to silence people on set who really just don't make any sense.
And action.
Mike, you are the shamalama ding dong. Get it right. Fix it. Make it work.
I mean, I'd love to be able to tell you who actually kind of fluffed their lines strictly between you and me. It could have been Jack.
Come on in. Let me introduce you to the peeps, my crew. This is that. I don't care, Mike. You're the sound recordist. Make it work.
That's awesome. Awesome, guys.
Another day on set. Well, yeah, it's a good scene. It's a good scene today. I think it'll shape up really well.
It was a long, hard, rugged day. Sometimes you just... you gotta get smelly, you gotta get hot, you gotta push it to the limits in the field of sound. And today I think we took it to the limit.
This is about day 118 of the shoot, although it's really a second unit day. Randy's in here, I'm just coming in because it's too much fun to miss.
And, of course, I just get to sit back and take a snooze while Pete runs the set.
Well, I wasn't intending to do that.
You weren't intending to. This is too much like good fun. Yeah.
We're into the first of 4 days' worth of shooting the Hell Divers, which are the biplanes that attack Kong on the Empire State Building. Curtis Hell Divers, they're the American naval plane of the early 1930s, and they are the same aircraft as what they used on the original film. After a bit of research, we found out that no original Hell Divers existed. We were expecting to be able to copy one that was in a museum in the States or somewhere, but we found out that no museums have one, that it's actually an extinct aircraft, that they're all gone. And you can't even buy a plastic model kit of this plane, so we had to go to the Smithsonian and gather together the original factory drawings for the plane so we could actually recreate one.
So we started with original drawings and decided to build the airplane just like they did in the factory in 1933. All the sizes and shapes and everything on this airplane is true to the original form. The plane is built out of steel tube and given its shape with aluminum stringers and covered with fabric just like the real airplane would have been. It's just putting the fabric on the bare structure is the easy bit. Then we need to put reinforcing tapes over the ribs and rib stitch it with a needle right through. And then there's all kinds of paint that goes on top of it. There's about three coats of clear dope,
Then there's three more coats of silver, and then the top coat, whatever color it is.
It does have a few original parts that would have been the same parts used on a real Helldiver. The wheels and an instrument or two to make it authentic.
Where's my friggin' pilot?
Our pilot is Jim Dietz, who's a very renowned military artist. I've actually got some of his World War I flying paintings on the wall of my office. And the gunner is Rick Porras, who was our co-producer on all three Lord of the Rings movies. Rick's just come down to New Zealand for a vacation. He's not working on Kong, but he's jumped in the gunner seat. So I'm sitting here thinking these guys are actually really having all the fun, aren't they?
I just want to go into a real one now, not after we've been sitting in this, but I heard that there really aren't any Helldivers around anymore, so that's a bit unfortunate, but it's just really, it's got a good feeling with the wind. You almost feel like you're up there for real.
It will be memorable, as they say, into the sunset.
You know, the trick with this sort of stuff is to make sure the planes don't look too much like they're stuck in a studio. Obviously, the blue screen gets replaced with the skies and Manhattan, but we're doing a lot of things like moving the sun. We have the sun on the end of a big crane, and we swing that around so that you really get this great moving shadow effect. And we're putting a lot of vibration into the plane, a lot of vibration into the camera, so all the wires, you know, the flying wires that are holding the plane together kind of vibrating, and, you know, we're trying to sort of add that level of realism to what's essentially faking the flying. You know, everything's fake, isn't it, really, DJ?
Everything's fake except those hot shells that are flying all over the place.
The guns aren't fake. The guns are real guns.
Projects like this are really cool in a way. I mean, none of these airplanes exist anywhere, and we've just created one from scratch, and now there is a Curtis Helldiver. If it ends up in a museum somewhere, people from all over can actually come and see one, touch one, and have an idea what one of these airplanes actually looks like.
Never really grow up, do you? Boys never grow up. Planes and guns. Big,
right.
Big model planes. That's cool.
Hi, this is day 120 of our production diary, and we're getting towards the end of the film. We're here in the wet, dank K-stage jungles of Skull Island, doing a little bit more with Naomi and some dinosaurs today. Second unit of filming Adrien, doing a little bit of cab driving. It's interesting, movies don't really end with a climactic kind of moment. They tend to dwindle, and it becomes a process of long goodbyes.
Guess what? That was Jack's last shot, everybody.
Over the last couple of weeks, we've said goodbye to Jack Black. He finished everything that Denham had to do, and so he was able to leave.
I get squeezes. That's part of the fun. Uh-huh.
Colin Hanks, playing Preston, left. We're now down to, I think it's three more days of shooting with Adrien.
You know, I'm hanging out on a rope with Naomi on my back, and, you know, a couple little scenes to pick up, a few stunts, and I'm home free for a bit. But I'm aware that, you know, reshoots, maybe a few weeks, maybe another movie.
And reset, that was good. That was a good one, Adrien. That's cool.
Adrien has a couple more days. There's a scene in a theatre, which is the last set, I think, that's being built.
So this is the Arty Theatre. This is what you call a set within a set. So we've built a set, which is the theatre, and then we've built a backdrop, which is the set, and that's sort of happening as we speak. So here we are in the Empire State Building in Q stage. This is a set we've just put together over the last few weeks, and it's going to be shooting in 2 days' time.
Today's also a sad day for us because the New York set out in the Hutt Valley is being demolished. We wanted to have our wrap party in the New York set, except we had this demolition date and we couldn't keep the set till the very end of the shoot because it had to be gone and we had to clear it away. But nonetheless, it was a good day, an amazing party on the New York streets.
So I'd just like you to all give a huge welcome to Neil Finn.
Good afternoon all. Fantastic to be here.
And now today, the set gets demolished.
While it's nice and quiet in here, it's really busy out at New York streets. The guys are starting to strike it. Now, normally we'd just smash it all up and put it in the rubbish, but we are saving a lot of New York streets.
What we do when we destroy sets is we keep little bits of them just in case we want to do more filming with them later.
there is, you know, possibility we may use it for some pickups or maybe even another film.
And action!
Naomi, we hang on to till almost the very end. You know, we deliberately planned our schedule so that we would just be able to reduce things down to shots of Naomi at the very end. And so we're slowly reducing the size of our crew. Obviously, as we get down to shooting with two actors and then one actor, you don't need as many people in the wardrobe department, makeup departments, you know, the ADs department. It's sort of the film just becomes smaller. You end up almost like you're making a home movie by the time you're done. And it doesn't really ever get any easier. I mean, the scenes that we're shooting with Naomi at the very end, the very complicated effect scenes, lots of interaction between her and Kong and dinosaurs with blue screens and having to comp in creatures. So it sort of keeps your brain going right till the very end. So that's what our next 2 weeks holds. You know, the lights at the end of the tunnel, it's a good feeling. Everyone's enjoying just getting the film shot now, and that's what we're facing in this last couple of weeks.
Cut. Good.
Cut, thank you.
I think that was fine.
Hello, welcome to Production Diary for day 123. For the last 2 or 3 months, something's been going on behind the scenes that's sort of exciting, and today is the day that Universal have allowed us to talk about it for the first time. So very soon after our Christmas break, Universal started to talk to Fran, Philippa and myself about the idea of a possible sequel to King Kong. And based on that, we've now solidified our plans for what would be effectively the Son of Kong.
Yeah, this is just tremendously exciting for us, you know, Universal. We had some production money stashed away for the second Chronicle of Riddick, but we're not producing that particular picture. So happily, we had a significant budget, and we're going to make Son of Kong with it immediately.
Because the screenplay is reasonably long and pretty rich, Universal have agreed that we're basically going to split it into two movies and shoot them back to back.
One of the things Universal is best at, renowned for, is the franchise business. So it's just a phenomenal opportunity for us.
It was a little tricky getting the main cast back because, as you can imagine, you know, with Adrien, Naomi and Jack, they had already been making plans.
It's a relief for me that it's finally out of the bag because it was a top secret for so long I couldn't even tell my family or anything about what was going on.
If anyone has been paying attention, you know, we've sort of been dropping little clues. I'm really excited because, you know, I've never been in a sort of a sequel before. I've never been in like a franchise thing.
It's quite a great experience for me and my character because she discovers when she hears that back in the jungle, there, you know, Son of Kong is still alive. She, you know, a la kind of Sigourney Weaver, Gorillas in the Mist, runs back to the jungle because she wants to be there and nurture him because she owes that to King Kong himself.
It takes place like 10 years after the first one, so it's right in the middle of World War II.
Denham returns to Skull Island, except Denham now is involved with the US government's war effort. And so it's a great opportunity to return to Skull Island, but then the story actually ultimately climaxes in Europe.
It's weird. We go to Germany with Son of Kong and he helps us defeat Hitler.
Rather than just have Son of Kong fighting, you know, more dinosaurs on Skull Island, he is going to be able to combat some genetically mutated creatures that the Nazis are building. And so, as you can imagine, Weta are now, you know, gearing up to basically do the conceptual art.
So in total parallel with all the work that we've been doing on Kong, the likes of Rob and the other sculptors have simultaneously been sculpting these characters, like the 17-foot-tall albino that we see standing here.
And we're very lucky to have Andy Serkis coming back too to play Son of Kong.
I just had this idea for Son of Kong. It sounded ridiculous at the time, but, you know, Pete's up for anything. I said, can we do some motion capture using my son, Louis? Because Louis's now 9 months. He's 9 months old, and it's exactly the same as an infant gorilla. So, in fact, next week, we're going to be doing the first motion capture on a child. Well, not even, I mean, he's not even a child, he's a baby.
The previous team started with some very simple ideas of just how Son of Kong would walk and run.
There's a one scene where I'm kind of like riding on his back, me and Adrien and Naomi.
So in Son of Kong, there's quite a lot of comedy sequences and fun stuff, but there's also a couple of really good action sequences.
So one of the things we're gonna have to do is on the shoulders of the gorilla, we wanna mount a couple of Browning machine guns.
and we're now just starting to do some of the more major sequences, particularly a very involved sequence involving Russian T-34 tanks and Kong just outside the Führer bunkers.
So this is actually our very first set that we've designed for the sequels, for Kong 2 and 3. It's a Bavarian chalet where Denham is going to have his headquarters when he's behind the lines in World War II. We'll probably have to go on location to Europe later on in the year, about 3 weeks of location work, where we'll need to just gather those, you know, the castles and the towns and the wide shots that will establish the European feel, which we don't have that sort of stuff here in New Zealand.
One of the hardest parts of doing it is actually prepping for the stuff we're going to be shooting in Europe later on, sort of trying to get together studio space, get gear ready to go over, get our lighting continuity packages sorted out.
It'd just be nice to be somewhere else that's just a little different. It'd be nice to get away from the blue screens just a bit more.
Of course, it's made these final weeks of shooting the first movie rather complicated because we basically have very little pre-production time. So my day on set these days is basically shooting scenes with Naomi for the first film, and at the same time I'm just having impromptu meetings all over the place to try to organise what needs to be organised for films 2 and 3.
Simon, if we could just make sure these trees are kept secure for 2 or 3 months, and we'll look forward to getting back in the jungle here later on this year.
So it's going to be a busy year for us, and you'll be able to follow it all here on The Kong is King.
That looks great. That's a fantastic collar.
I think wardrobe's an important part of King Kong because it, you know, we are telling a period story, so the sets and the costumes are what take you into that world.
My research of this started with the original film, so we wanted to keep it true to that 30s style of filmmaking, and it sort of embraced so many areas that the original had, like, you know, vaudeville and burlesque, and it tries to show the very dark side of New York that you see.
Basically, the process starts by Terry gives us a design and we do a pattern. We make up a toile, which is a mock-up in a plain fabric, and we get that as close as possible and do any alterations. And then we cut it out in the real fabric and machining and hand sewing and all sorts of things, and we've finished the end.
There's this dress that has caused a lot of drama. We had a scene a long time ago that had this dress in it called the locket scene. We all loved this dress, but the scene went. So we've rewritten a new scene for this dress, done in gold.
It's beautiful fabric. Silk gauze.
And it's a good moment for her because she's got to look overdressed and fluffy. And I think we're going down the fluffy road here.
Well, I say, what a lovely dress.
Oh, this old thing. I just threw it on.
In previous scenes, like the New York streets, we hired a lot of costumes from Australia, England and LA. It was just really the vast quantities of period that we needed there that we couldn't possibly have manufactured.
Yeah, we've dressed about 3,000 people. I reckon we've easily made 1,500 costumes.
We're going for gold here, guys. We want it to look gorgeous.
And act.
It'd be really nice to use original worn-out clothes on, say, the sailors. But just the nature of the beast is that each of those sailors has to get wet, bloodied, muddied, so they can't just have one costume. They have to have multiples of that costume. So the only way we can do that is to make them new and then put them through a process that takes them to a stage where they look like these guys have lived in them for the past 5 years.
This is the breakdown area, and these are Jack Driscoll's shirts. And so basically they all have to be done the same. In this case, it's a lot of raw under paint and then this kind of artificial mud that you've got here.
And of course it all has to be permanent dirt because they can't wear them for 6 months without having them laundered. So it all has to be permanent so they can be washed and they come out of the washing machine looking as bad as they went in. They just smell a lot better.
Peter, come on down. We'll take you down for the fitting.
Today we did fittings for the Arty Theatre. It's actually where Jack Driscoll's written a play. And we're going for a slightly quirkier 30s look. The men are just really in pinstripe suits and sort of outrageous ties, but the ladies have been really interesting today because we've done some pretty interesting designs on them. You know, strong tailored silhouettes with really geometric hats. So it's quite an interesting thing for the ladies.
Cool. You look sensational.
I feel it.
Great.
Fantastic.
The costumes are very important to get the feel of the period right, and also where you are in terms of how rich people are or how poor people are. It gives you those senses. So wardrobe's an important part of every movie, but particularly in King Kong, and it looks amazing, so it's been a really enjoyable one as well.
Hello, welcome to day 127, and we have a video diary today that some of you have requested. Mark and Jean-Philippe and others have wanted to know what the unit photographer does. The unit photographer is the stills photographer. We're using a gentleman called Pierre Vinay, and Pierre has been on every one of my movies since Brain Dead.
This is a hat that my mother made for Pierre. Brain Dead.
I've been with Peter for 13 years, and the thing I like about being a still photographer for Peter is I don't really have a budget of how much I can shoot. It's shoot everything.
Action! It's a critically important role because the stills photographer produces the first images of the movie that anyone ever sees. They see the stills a long, long time before they see the movie normally. The stills always provide the first impression of the film.
So far, I shot about 60,000 pictures on this production. What you have to do is you have to create the mood of the photograph that the director is trying to create.
Bikes.
They're going to be used for publication, internet, poster, marketing. That's why it's important that you capture the mood. And I know that my still with Peter Jackson represent the film. You look at one shot and you know that that is King Kong. That's what we did yesterday. Action shot. Look at that. Is that a nice picture or not? It's pretty cool, man.
All the photographs that you see in books and magazines are photographs that they take. They're not actually the same camera angles as what the real movie camera is filming because they can't be in the same space at the same time. So the unit photographer has to actually look for a shot which is as good as the film camera shot. And the film camera shot usually has the prime position. So the photographer has to sneak in and around and try to get a different angle, but something that's going to be strong and powerful.
The idea is for a photographer is you don't want to be heard and you don't want to be seen. So you move very quiet on a film set without disturbing, especially your actor. So you really have to be gentle and develop a really good relationship with the actor.
I'm going to play a joke today. The joke's going to be on Naomi. So...
Yeah, hi.
So you guys are going where?
Yeah. That's very believable.
Are
you
going to
fright?
No, I'm laughing. I would think it would be Jack Black, but I think he's in America.
And who else would it be?
Yeah.
Process of elimination.
Yeah.
Every day I come on set and Peter's going to pull a surprise out. When he told me I'm going to do this photographer scene of the film, I know I can be a photographer, but I don't know if I can play the part, you know?
We do two takes, right? If they don't like it after two takes, we'll come back tomorrow.
Okay.
Do a couple more.
It's fifth.
We're not doing four or five takes, man.
All the film I've done with Peter, when he told me I'm going to do King Kong, that brought a big smile on my face. I'm not much of a smiler, but that brought me a smile.
I hope this is working properly. This is Andy Serkis here. We're going to do a web episode to get our revenge on the DVD crew. They don't know I'm making this, but for 8 months, they've been driving us nuts, sticking the camera in our faces, following us around everywhere that we've ever been. If it's all a bit rough, then forgive me, but they don't know I'm doing this. All right, cheers, see you later. Bye.
So I'm making this for CollinsKing.net and the DVD crew. Oh. Don't know about it, and I'm going to cut it together, and it's a...
Oh, we're turning the tables on them. We're giving them a taste of their own medicine. They're going to feel the pain. Yeah. Make them feel the pain, Andy. Yeah.
Well, I'd actually like to DVD them in various state of pain and embarrassment. And we probably like them really well as well, because they never get that bit right.
I think it's high time that someone actually got a bit of footage of these guys who have hassled us for the last, I don't know how many weeks, but it seems like every second day that someone's, Jeff, what are you doing here today?
Ah, it's a love-hate relationship. Yeah.
It's irritating, invasive, and they get in your f***ing way.
Well, it's very invasive. It sort of invades your constitutional rights as a crew member to just do what you do without having a camera in your face the whole time. I mean, basically, I fucking love it.
So my question is it voyeurism? I mean, anyone can get up with a video camera and make their own film. It's the easiest thing in the world. I mean, you could all do it. So are these people really earning their money, or are they just a complete sham? That's what I want to know.
Yeah, you guys do a great job. You do, but you're always in the face!
That does not disturb me, but it's when they're behind you, when you turn.
It's totally different when it's actually pointed at us. It's like...
With one of these, you can tell what person's body language is from 100 feet away. You can tell whether people are having a good day at work, a bad day at work, or whatever. I mean, check this out.
It'd be interesting changing gears. Because we'll be less in the world of... You know what I mean? Like...
Look, Madison, I'm going to take you inside the vault. Look, this is KKO395. 395. What's on this one? Naomi shopping in town. Colin clubbing it at the Matterhorn. Okay, so I've actually now secretly removed all my most embarrassing moments. I mean, moments that you just wouldn't want to see me. I mean, that would completely ruin your image of me. Ah! Looking through 1,800 tapes, I discovered different actors respond in totally different ways.
Yeah, we're cool.
Yep, on the other end, Jack's a ham.
Fight! Run for your lives!
Excuse me, Miss Watts. Hi, I'm doing a day in the life of the DVD crew, and you've just done a really hard day's filming, and now I'm just going to follow you with a camera, and when you're really exhausted, can you just tell me how you feel about that?
Cough.
I mean, you know, these days, you can't just sign on and get a job. You can't just, you know, get a part in a film, get offered a role, and then actually go and carry it out. Oh, no, you have to do this thing called B-roll and behind the scenes and DVD footage, and it's like living in Big Brother all the time, you know, and to the point where it drives you absolutely insane. People can't leave you alone. You just can't even go to the toilet. You can't even pick your nose. You can't go anywhere. People are just following you. It just drives you nuts. It drives you crazy. But no, they keep going. They keep going, and they think it's really interesting, every single living, breathing thing that you do, every single second of every day.
Everywhere. I have to slam the door on their face when I go to the toilet.
No, Andy, actually, I haven't finished yet. I know you're on your way home.
Yes, but no, I'm on my way to Rush's.
Oh, you're on your way to Rush's?
Yeah. We've got another hour, yeah.
Okay, well, can I follow you to Rush's?
Well, no. No. Look, it's more interesting here. Oh,
okay, welcome to day 125 or 6 or 7 or whatever it is of our shoot. I can't quite remember what day it is, to tell you the truth, but I know one important thing, it's the last week of shooting, it's our final week, and this is when you've got to really pace yourself, make sure that you're not like one of those runners who trips just before the finishing line and ends up face down in the mud. When you collapse the day after the shoot finishes, not the day before. You know, I do have a few thoughts and ideas of how I'm going to actually get through this last week. I've got a plan.
The Beatles said it best, with a little help from your friends.
Hey, Matt, can you get Brian Singer on the line? Brian Singer, I think he's in Sydney.
Hi, can I speak to Brian, please? I've got Peter calling for him.
Hello.
Hey, Peter.
Is that Brian?
Is it he?
Thanks for taking my call.
Yeah.
How busy are you at the moment?
We moved in the night, so I'm at the office just going through pre-vis.
I'm just wondering if we could do a little favour, like a little swap
sort of thing, maybe. I'm sort of running on fumes at the moment, so
yeah.
It would be kind of helpful to have another pair of eyes who I can trust, kind of sort of looking over my shoulder, and I could have a little rest or a little snooze or something. And I figured if you're on 16-hour days, then it leaves like 8 hours that you wouldn't be doing anything.
You mean there?
Well, yeah.
Thank you, Seamus.
Brian's not really here to direct as such. He's here on the just for the eventuality that I might fall asleep, just in case. Try hard not to. Just give me a yell if you need me, Brian.
Okay. Cool. All right. I'm on a kind of a flip two film kind of schedule thing, so we may just do these sort of in one take.
Keep it rolling on, yeah.
So, yep. Keep it moving.
When Naomi gets, where is Naomi, by the way?
I mean, I know he's got great films, but he can't just walk in on a set and say, I'm going to direct this bit.
But at least he's a really good director.
Yeah, no, that's true.
At least he has somebody.
If Peter feels safe, I guess I have to feel safe. Just kind of have to go with it. I mean, sometimes that's what this is about, filmmaking. You know, run with the ball, I say.
Eyes awake. I've only seen this previs. Clearly, Kong is powerful. I get his height, I understand. But what does he... Can he... fly?
You know, a little worrying that our director is just, you know, nodding off, but understandable because this is a heavy schedule.
All right, everyone, we'll shoot this one. You charge each other. Colin, yeah, she's going to step back once. And action! Colin, T-Rex is coming. Back up. Next, sort of between his arms, they're around you. All right, and he charges. Right, and cut. Okay.
Oh. So what time will you be able to make it tomorrow? Because I'm probably going to need a little bit of help tomorrow.
Sure. Well, I'll do the best I can. I'll try to get here by 10, like, 10.
Okay.
You feel good?
Cool.
Hang in there.
Yeah,
safe trouble.
So this is our last day today, and I'm not going to have Brian coming in today. He's done a great job, a real Superman, but I'm going to finish this film like a man. I'm doing it myself. I'm staying awake.
So, Peter's asleep again, gang. This is our last shot. We've got to get it done. Can you hurry and get Frank in here, please?
Copy that. Bringing Frank onto set, yep.
Copy, Caro. Frank's travelling now.
Yeah, I was standing by for Frank.
Hi, Frank.
Hello.
Hey, everybody. This is Frank Darabont. I'm sorry, Peter's fallen asleep again. We've got to get this last shot, so he's going to direct this shot.
Great
team, this is Frank.
Oh, thank you.
Hi, Frank.
Hi. Pleasure to meet you. Has everybody checked Peter's pulse? Is he
no.
Narcoleptic kind of deal?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Well, I'll be over there. Let's roll with him. Why not?
All righty, so let's lock down the studio, please. We're going to shoot. Lock it down.
And cut!
Cut.
That was really, the suit just isn't working.
You don't like the suit?
No, I just don't.
Maybe it doesn't match the previous take.
We should do one with Naomi then.
We've got to get it from a human girl's voice.
Here, Peach, we should play it back.
Right, print it and check the gate, please.
Yeah, no, whatever you want. Yeah. I'm just going to have a little snooze.
All right, good. Next setup.
Okay.
Today is the last day.
Let's
shoot. This is the last shot.
So we finally got to day 131, which was our official end of principal photography.
What's the last setup for main unit? But I'm still pretending it's the last setup for Eva, even though we'll be back on Monday.
Okay, guys.
I don't want to finish, really. I don't want to finish. I want to stay here. Keep shooting. Forever and ever and ever and ever. Stay in Wellington.
The last week or two have been fun, enjoyable. The light was at the end of the tunnel. And so it was very much working closely with Naomi and obviously with Andy Serkis. It was kind of bittersweet, you know. I think everyone was on one level relieved to get to the last day, but you're also painfully aware that it's the end of friendships that have been made. This period of our lives is over, and it's a very intense feeling when you're shooting a movie. You do bond closely with the crew and the cast that are working with you, and suddenly it's all over.
Oh.
I think we're done.
Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you very, very much. We're sort of done for the time. That is also Naomi and Andy's last shot as well. So.
We had some farewells. I got a lovely signed photograph from the crew where every single member of the crew had signed it.
Oh, wow. Whoa. Oh, this is so cool. This is really great. Thank you.
I somehow tricked myself into thinking that one film would be a little easier than three. But as it turned out, it has been a very difficult film to make. And, you have been an absolutely wonderful group of people to work with. I've needed all the support that you gave me. I really have needed it, and you've always been there and always stepped up to the challenge.
Put that camera away and come and have a party with us. Come on, you deserve it. Earned it.
For me, I'm relieved to get through the shoot because you sit down and you study everything that you did shoot over the last 6 or 7 months and you basically craft the movie out of it. These production diaries have been a lot of fun and they are going to continue. We're going to do one diary per week during post-production and we've got a very complicated post ahead of us.
Serkis near you. He's a vicious man who will humiliate you.
I'm doing a day in the life of following the DVD crew around. And,
well, you've lost them already.
Hi, good morning.
It's me, sneaky. It's me. Nobody knows I'm here.
What's with the camera?
Oh, I'm just doing this thing for myself. I'm just collecting a few memories just for when I go home.
Yeah. Whoa! What was that?
Knock it off!
No, I have not been invaded over the last 8 months.
Normally, you can pick your nose in total freedom and luxury, but when you're being filmed all the time, bodily functions are at the top of your mind.
Can I just
got an email.
You got it.
I can't think of anything more annoying than having a camera all day right in front of you. Yeah.
Is that one of our cameras?
No. This is.
Look at their own game.
Stay away from her.
It's all payback.
Hey.
Hey.
How are you? I've got a lot of dirt on you guys. A lot of dirt.
I've managed to avoid the whole DVD behind the scenes process for the bulk of the show, which is great.
Yeah, I feel like they're in my space. I like to have this bubble around me and they just come and invade your privacy.
It gives the general public a very good understanding of what we do in the film industry, doesn't it? And it sells DVDs.
Ah! You want a banana? How many times you hear that on this set?
Quite a few times, Adam. You're not the first.
You know, I'll tell you something about Adam. Is he'll ask you to do a production diary. He says, look, it's going to take half an hour to an hour, and it winds up taking 3 days.
Actually, I seem to remember you milked it quite a lot in your 15 minutes.
Oh, you better believe it. I'm still riding it, sucker.
Do you often have a lot of time off then?
Oh, we're working hard right now.
Yeah,
yeah. This is it. This is how it gets done.
Take the camera, chuck it out there, and do a victory dance.
Our pillar and boys, they're really cool. We love them.
I was not too impressed when I first saw them on the first day. But now, actually, I don't like them.
Leave me alone. They rank beyond our camera crew. They should be DPing the whole thing. In fact, can the movie bring on behind the scenes?
I kind of feel a bit bad that I've, said the things I've said about the DVD crew. I think they're actually very, very valuable because I think it is worth recording all the things that happen on this film for your enjoyment. I'm going to finish off by saying that they're a really cool bunch of people and I want them to continue to follow me around so that I don't feel rejected. Okay, bye.
Here we go, and action!
So, Jack, what we might do is we'll just get you to help us with that timing with Rick, and if he's a little late, let him get there and get his hand in and then say step on him.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Because I can cut my way around that if you just let him get there.
Yes.
Because at that point, you just don't touch the car. So.
Okay.
Yeah. Which will be good. I mean, it'll be fine because I can easily just cut from side to side.
Good.
Apart from that, I thought it was perfect.
Good.
Flawless.
Cool.
How does that look?
Let's have a look. One camera at a time. Okay, so this is Cameron's camera. So this is the one where the fist goes plonk. So that's a little bit too much of a sort of...
Yeah, it was a bit fake.
A bit of arm wavy.
Yeah.
He's gonna go crazy, and he's gonna charge you guys on his knuckles, and your guys are gonna be going like crazy with your gun, trying to wheel your gun around.
Start me, and then we're supposed to start me. Be very deliberate with me. Nobody's going past you. Like it happened afterwards. Yeah, that's a good one.
Hey, you! Stop!
I'm scared of that.
But I think
I'm scared of it.
Otherwise, if that happens, Rick, jump on the tailboard and just go for a ride.
Thanks. Go for a ride.
Don't scrape.
But the
idea would be that as the cab roars away, you're just putting your hand out and you're just sort of standing here, kind of watching it go.
My only note was your first landing was a little bit close to the edge when that first one where you go onto your front.
Very exciting,
wasn't it?
Extremely exciting. High action.
Peter said that looked very exciting.
Yeah, well that's good. I thought it looked really exciting too.
Three, two, one, action!
And cut.
Nothing.
That was real good. That was real good, Cara. I think we've got him.
Sure, we'll just do one more for luck, okay?
Okay, I'm just gonna close this project, which is they're doing day 126, which is I think it's about wardrobe or something. So I'm gonna close it and then I can edit the one that I'm gonna send to you.